Well, happy Sunday and welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks. Thanks for giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly appreciate you. Y'all, please do me a favor and show my moderator, Love Jones, a little love, please, and thank you. And also, please make sure to like the video on your way in the door. And if you're feeling froggy, drop down in the comments and say, hey, girl, hey. And if you haven't already, please consider subscribing to the channel, making sure to click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on a single chapter. Now, with that being said, welcome to all of my brand new sippers and speakers. I appreciate you subscribing, and I hope that you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my wonderful returning sippers and speakers, as well as those of you catching this on the replay. Thanks for coming back one more again to love up on your girl, because y'all know that I love the way that y'all love on me. All right. So, y'all, this is going to be a quick little skippity-pap, child. Like, for real, for real. So, let me see. All right. Got the book. And let me say hey to y'all who are here. All right. Hey, Tenacious. Welcome, boo. Happy Sunday. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. And the same to you, Shanae, and Missouri, and Tracy J. And hey, Love Jones, annoyingly wonderful little sister with your late ass and moderator extraordinaire. Thank you for being here, boo. I appreciate you. She like, what the fuck kind of backhanded compliment was that? That's one hell of a welcome. That's what that is. Hey, girl. Hey. Hey, Jaleesa. Welcome. And you too, Tiffany. Said is in the building. All right. I see who was paying attention to them notifications today. I see whose notifications were working. All right, I'm happy about that. All right, so let me get this damn timestamp, child, because we only have 4 chapters and an epilogue. We probably going to be up here maybe 1 hour and 45 minutes, and then y'all will be free to roam about the country. All right, so let me get this timestamp so we can get on started, and the rest of these folks, I guess, are come busting their asses up in here late, having to red ball it back. Yeah, so, you know, hey. So she said mine wasn't working. I just been checking all day. Oh, Lord. Okay. Now, that's some loyalty for your ass right there. Thank you, Seti said. Boo, I appreciate you. All right, here we go. Chapter 18, Nashe Nene Parker. Thank you. You have a good day, I said to the cashier behind the counter at the edible arrangement store that I was in. I was picking up a beautiful fruit basket for pleasure because I knew how much that woman loved fruit, along with a teddy bear and a couple of balloons. My girl was going through it, and I knew those small tokens, along with the things I had inside the car, weren't going to help cheer her up in any way. But it was a start, and it was me putting in that effort to show my girl that I cared. It had been 2 days since Pleasure had to have an emergency C-section to deliver the twins. Couture and Kairu were in that NICU fighting their little asses off for a spot in this world because they deserved to be here just like everyone else. Those little babies were so powerful, and I was holding on to all the hope in the world that they would make it out of that part of the hospital, get their weight up, and be the nice and healthy. No, and be nice and healthy for Corporate and Pleasure to bring home. I was sure of that when I got the call from Sade 2 days ago. Late at night, I already knew it was going to be some bullshit. Never in a million years did I think she would call me and tell me that Pleasure had to get rushed to the hospital because she was in pain and was bleeding. Instantly, I started thinking the worst, feeling like she might have been miscarrying while praying all the while that it wasn't the case for her. Thank God that KJ was with my mom and I was able to quickly slip something on. I stayed at that hospital from the moment I got there, which was a little after 10 at night, until 8 o'clock the next morning. I only left to go home, shower, and go back. All of us were there to support P in corporate. Me, Sanai, Kanye, Koi, Asia, and Rika had all shown up, and along with Sade, she'd come with Big Ma after grabbing her from Radija's house. Colony had come with Corporate and P, and Cody and Chaotic had all shown up too. When I say Big Ma closed the doors in the waiting area and prayed those hospital walls down for those twins, I mean it. She had everybody in the room crying from the powerful prayer that she'd put out, and with a prayer like that, those babies were sure to make it. I was positive. After getting the items in my car, I pulled out of the parking lot and went across the street to put some gas in my car. I was one of those people who wouldn't gas up until my car was literally telling me that I could only do 10 more miles before it shut off on me. I'd had that bad trait for years, back when I was with Chaotic. I'd gotten used to him taking my cars to get detailed every Saturday morning. He made sure my tires were already good, the oil was good, and he made sure I was always gassed up. I never had to worry about that kind of stuff, but when I became single again, those things were placed back in my hands, and I was playing with fire. I had to laugh to myself now because Chaotic had threatened me on numerous occasions that if I ever called and told him that our son and I were stuck on the side of the road due to me running out of gas, he was going to curse my ass out, find us, and take KJ while I figured it out since I wanted to be stupid. Damn. Okay. Granted, I knew his shit-talking ass wasn't going to do it, and that's why I found it so comical. There was something about my damn baby daddy that I couldn't shake. Chaotic was my weakness. He had the power to make a bitch laugh, even when I ain't want to. He was easily the funniest person that I've ever met in my life. He came with good vibes, and he was going to compliment your ass to death. That was probably why the hoes loved his ass so much, because if some shit stood out about you and he liked it, he would tell you. Chaotic was a ladies' man. The nigga had eyes, and he used the fuck out of them. All of which were things I knew when he pursued me, and I still chose to fuck with him. Chaotic and I had good times together. It just ultimately didn't work out because that cheating scandal was too much for me. But here we are, 6 years later, and I'm back fucking him. I can't shake the nigga again. I was allowing him to break my ass down. Yesterday morning, when I left the hospital to go home and shower and stuff, he left with me. We got to my house where he fucked the shit out of me in the shower. I cooked him breakfast and we ate, only to get fucked again on top of the kitchen counter, which had us back in the shower together all over again. He'd already asked if he could take me out on a date once things got a little better with the twins, and I agreed. I think this time around, Chaotic realized how badly he fucked up, and I could see in his eyes how much it meant to him to get his family back. So, yes, I was giving him another chance, and if I got hurt for the second time, that was nobody's fault but mine. I pulled up to the gas station, and a message came through from Koi asking me where I was. She was already at the hospital. I texted her back, letting her know that I was getting gas and I'd be there in about 15 minutes because I wasn't too far from the hospital. My passenger window was down, and I heard loud laughter and talking coming from the pump on the side of me. I turned my head to look, and out of all the bitches in the fucking world, I spotted Tanisha. She was standing outside of a beautiful lime green Corvette, and one of her homegirls had her phone in her hand taking pictures of her. Seeing the bitch had me wanting to get out of my car and slap the fuck out of her. But when you're in the line of business that I am, you have to lead by example. So I stayed my ass where I was. I wanted to slap her because Chaotic still hadn't told me what the bitch said about my son. But whatever it was, I knew it was bad enough for him to take his dick out of her mouth for good. I hated that Chaotic even got himself wrapped up with Tanisha. When they were together, I never stressed it because I knew it wouldn't last. I knew she was just someone to fill the void I left since he couldn't have me. If I had told a nigga to come home, even if he was in a full relationship with her, he would have always come, and that's why that little relationship has always been a joke to me. I stepped out of my car, and even though my back was turned to them, I could feel their eyes on me. Hopefully, they chose to keep shit cute, because that's exactly what I was going to do as I used my car to pay for my gas. I got the pump in the nozzle and let it automatically fill up on its own as I sat in the driver's seat with the door open, watching it fill up. By that time, Tanisha and her friend had gotten back in their cars, and when they were about to pass me, I saw the window roll down and I prepared myself for the clown activity that was about to occur. How you get them is how you lose them, bitch. The same way that nigga was fucking around on me, he's going to do the same shit to you. Tanisha called out from the car. Before a bitch could even fully stand up and get a word in, her scary ass had driven off. chaotic, and I hadn't even made our shit official. And here come the hoes out of the woodwork, making this shit feel like it did in our early years together when I had to deal with these dumbass bitches. That was why I fought chaotic so hard against getting back with him. My life was so peaceful these days, and I didn't need anything to alter that shit. I literally took my ass to work, hung out with my girls when I could fit it into my schedule, and the rest of the time, I was at home chilling with my son. I wasn't trying to be going at it with these bitches. I was too grown for that shit. I was liable to do some petty shit and slap cuffs on all of them bitches and send their asses to jail just because. Oh, I forgot she was a cop. Hell yeah, I'd be pulling bitches over, writing tickets for stupid shit. See you in court, bitch. Right, sorry. I refuse. That's a horrible abuse of power. But you know what? Fuck them. Hell, be careful who you fuck with. Leave people the fuck alone. I refused to let Tanisha get under my skin. So after my car was fully gassed up, I removed the pump, placed it back, and sanitized my hands. After about 10 more minutes, I pulled my car into the parking lot at the hospital. I was able to make it one trip upstairs by gathering everything in two hands. I made it inside, did a quick check-in, and then I took the elevator up to labor and delivery on the fourth floor. I headed to Pleasure's room. She was going to be discharged tomorrow, but you know, with the twins being premature, they would be there for a while longer. I made it in front of Pleasure's room door and quickly knocked. Within 2 seconds, the door opened and Corporate was standing there with the phone glued to his ear. Like the man he was, he cradled his phone to his ear and took everything from my hands while he finished up his conversation on the phone. He set the items down, gave me a quick hug, and stepped outside. When I walked into the room, Pleasure was sitting up in bed and Kanye's ass had set up shop in her room. He was styling Pleasure's hair as Sanai, Koi, and Big Ma sat around. Because Pleasure had a bunch of people who loved her and we didn't want it to feel like we were smothering her with our presence, we would all take turns coming by to see her. Pleasure was definitely down right now, but I knew this was just a short patch and she would eventually be in better spirits. How you doing, Mama? I asked after walking over and giving her a hug. She wasn't in her hospital gown. Instead, she was sitting there in a nice two-piece long-sleeve black pajama set. Kanye was almost done styling her hair. Pleasure was beautiful. She was just one of those women who it didn't matter the time of day because she would always be breathtaking. Even right now, while she was at her lowest, she was still beautiful as hell. I'm better, she responded. Her voice was still gone from all the screaming and breakdowns that she had. I picked up her hand that had the IV running through it, kissed the back of it, and then I laid it back down before I sat next to her on her hospital bed. I told P that I can't wait for Couture to get in my seat. I'ma give my niece her first silk press, Kanye stated, holding the flat iron. I laughed while shaking my head because leave it to him to say something crazy like that. 10 minutes later, the door opened and it was Corporate walking back in. This time, the phone wasn't glued to his ear and Chaotic was next to him with two big teddy bears in his hands, along with a big gift bag. Pleasure and those babies were getting spoiled rotten each day that someone came down here to visit them. They popped up with gifts. My eyes were on Chaotic. A bitch was trying to be discreet and not look because I wasn't trying to blow our cover, but his ass looked so damn good, making it hard not to look in his direction. He was dressed in a two-piece black Dickies outfit. The shirt was short-sleeved and all the buttons were open, showing the white tank top that he had underneath. The black bottoms fit him perfectly. Chaotic wouldn't wear his pants hanging off his ass, but they would hang just a little off his waist, and that was perfect for me. There were fresh black Gucci sneakers on his feet, and even though he was standing so far away, I could only bet that he smelled amazing. The waves in his hair were perfect as usual, and I stared at him. I found myself having flashbacks from the amazing sex that we had yesterday morning. If anything was going to give it away, it was going to be me not being able to control the lustful glares that I was giving him. Nay, admit you fucking, oops, sorry, Big Ma. Admit that you're back having sexual intercourse with your baby daddy, Kanye said. Oh, these niggas know they'll bust each other out, yo. I gotta always count on his messy ass to be the one to call somebody out. I turned my head to look at Big Ma, who was sitting on the couch dozing off, so she wasn't even paying Kanye and his messy ass any attention. I don't know what you're talking about, I responded. Chaotic laughed, and I shot him a look telling him to stop because that laugh made it seem like he knew something that only me and him knew about. What's funny, cousin? Sanai's messy ass asked. She stood and walked over to Chaotic. See, I wasn't even going to snap on Sanai because these days it just felt good to see my girl in better spirits. After Ahmad was killed, her ass went through it, and she was doing the absolute most on Instagram. I knew that half the shits that I posted was just to prove a point that Ahmad spent more time with her than he did with the rest of the 20-plus women who had been posting him after his passing. That man was dealing with so many damn women to the point that it was embarrassing as hell. If I had any affiliation with the nigga, there's no way in hell I would have posted myself with him. Sanaa was posting videos of them laid up in bed kissing, screenshots of their messages, and just a bunch of shit to ruffle his baby mama's feathers, along with other bitches who were dealing with him. She'd eventually stop doing it, and I knew it was because Chaotic snapped on her about it. He'd already told me about the conversation that he had with her. Anyway, she was much better now, and I was happy to see her smiling. Nothing. Chill out. Anybody in the NICU right now? I know we can only go two at a time, and I want to see my babies, Chaotic called out. His question had me smiling like a damn dummy, just loving a hard man being able to soften up when it came to little babies. I could see the love in Chaotic's eyes when he referred to his niece and nephew as his babies. Nobody in there, and they ain't been. Y'all can go together, Corporate suggested. I wanted to see the baby, so I stood up from the bed, hugged Pleasure for a second, and let her know that I would be right back. Then I walked over to the door that Chaotic was holding open and walked out. He was on my heels, following right behind me. I don't want them to be together. Y'all want me to skip their little part? Because I don't really care. I don't want to be with him, but I won't skip it. Anyway, you telling on yourself, love. Showing all fucking 32 teeth when I walk in the room, he said. I laughed as I hit him on his arm. I ran into your bitch at the gas station, I let him know. I don't got no bitch. I only got you, he responded, and hit the big button on the wall that opened the double doors to the lobby. I rolled my eyes at his response and shook my head. Who you saw? He questioned. Tanisha, her scary ass yelled some shit out the window to me, talking about the way you get them is how you lose them. Before I could even say something back, she pulled off, I told him, and he nodded. Nay, you have way more to lose than Tanisha does. You in law enforcement, and for that reason alone, you don't need to stoop down to her level. I know Tanisha for real. She fucking scary, and she not gonna bust a grape, so ignore all that shit, he responded, and pulled me to him by my arm, then wrapped me up in a bear hug. He was standing behind me, and I had my back against his chest as we continued walking together. My hand clutched his arm that he had wrapped around me, and I could feel myself melting. He smelled just as good as I knew he was gonna smell, and his lips came down to kiss me on my neck, breaking my ass down even more than I already was. This is fucking raggedy-ass nigga. You got me feeling like a fucking teenager all over again. I be having wet dreams and shit thinking about the way we be fucking, he told me. I laughed, but honestly, I felt the same. I swear I could be lying in bed or I could be out just like it was in Pleasure's hospital room and he could walk inside. I'd be forced to have flashbacks of the sex that he and I had. It was just that good, and I already knew that's what really played a part in why I always had that goofy-ass smile on my face that I couldn't even control whenever he walked into a room. Same, I told him, followed by a quick laugh. I turned my head to look at him over my shoulder, and even with him still hugged up on me, I was able to lean my head up and kiss him on the lips. Chaotic was looking at me like that quick peck on the lips wasn't enough to satisfy him, so I went in again. This time we tongue-kissed for a few moments until I pulled away and wiped away the excess gloss from his lips, and he let me go. We eventually made it over to the NICU, where we did a small check-in, and once inside, we put on the face masks that they'd given us, walked in, and found the twins. They were both lying in their own bassinet on their backs, with the machines hooked up to them and peacefully sleeping. I stood in front of Cairo's bassinet, and Chaotic was in front of Couture. Anyway. Because the way she spelled his baby's name is Couture. And it makes me think of Cardi B's little princess, Culture. Ooh, that's a pretty little girl. Good. Googly moogly. She's so cute. Anyway, we both looked down at them. I reached out and placed my finger on Cairo's little thigh. I just knew that Pleasure and Corporate would get the luxury of bringing them home because those little babies were fighting for their spot and I loved it. I can't wait until they get up out of here. I hate seeing them in here. Shit bring back memories of how it was with KJ. Those were the scariest days of my life, Chaotic revealed. KJ was premature, so chaotic, and I knew all about having to be in the NICU to visit your baby, watching him fight, and the eagerness that we had to bring him home. The same way KJ fought is the way Couture and Kairu are going to fight, I let him know. We stayed in there with them for a little over 30 minutes, and seeing them had saddened the mood a little between Chaotic and me, because it was always an emotional feeling to see such tiny babies be brought into this world and have to fight so hard. But I had hope that some good would come from all of this. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. All right, let me see who done came up in here. All right, I got Seti Sid and Tiffany. Erkin Jerk is in the building. Hey, girl, hey. And you too, Dior. And hey, lovely Mitchell, welcome. Let me see, where we at? Let me keep going. Hey, wifey, hey. Thank you for being here, darling. And you too, Jazzy, welcome, welcome. Let me see who else, child. I think I got, nope, Morris is here. Welcome, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. All right, I think that's it. Wait, not that's how they get over the one they really love, flip-flopping like a fish, right? Oh, my God, right. And I just feel like it's some bullshit, you know? I wish she would have been, you know, super strong, because, child, she wasn't ready. That's why she shouldn't have fucked him. See, if you can't fuck the nigga and then going on about your business, you know, then you shouldn't have fucked him. You know, she probably should have waited fucking 4 or 5 years. Child, the way I would have waited. Look, KJ would have been done, got up out his wheelchair, had a couple babies, and got a mortgage. And then I'd have been like, yeah, you can knock the dust off this motherfucker. I'm so fucking ignorant. Oh my God. But yeah, you can knock the dust off this motherfucker, but that's it, my guy. Get the fuck on, pimp. She should have had her a couple good fucking dudes in between. You know what I'm saying? Like, cause she wasn't ready. Now she all lost in the sauce again. Child, listen. And gonna end up fucking, I know, right? Shut up, Sid. He get on my fucking nerve with his long head ass. I just picture him as a dude with a long ass head. Oh, eraser head ass. Yeah. Ugh. Anyway, I don't like that. Yep, I'm petty as shit. I'm a whole Aquarius, child. I don't know what you thought. But this me. This is me. I know I'm fucking petty. And don't give a motherfucking motherfuck. All right. Chapter 19, Kyle Strong. And how you know that nigga again? My son, Kyrie, asked me over the phone. I was en route to meet with a new plug. I'd done my research and I learned that this was the same connect that Amiri was using before they killed that nigga. Now that the nigga was dead, I was sure the plug, Rodriguez, was looking for someone else to move his weight. I had faith that I could be a valuable asset to him. Kyrie had already jumped on board and he told me that if I got a connect, he would work alongside me. My son was loyal as fuck, and I vowed that when I got my business up and running, I would have him be my partner because I trusted this nigga way more than I trusted anyone in my entire family. Pause. Bitch, nigga, he only came with you by default because you're his fucking dad. Duh. If he knew what the fuck you had done, I'm thinking he might would have made a better decision. Your thought process is fucking wrecked, sir. Anyway, he could have crossed me and chosen to do business with corporate and them since that was the way he made his money, but he kept his loyalty with me after that nigga had pulled a gun on me and threatened to kill me. I couldn't even bring Keanu on board with us because he was talking about retiring. I hadn't talked to him in a while because I'd been too busy coming up with plans and shit, trying to find a way to make some money, but last we talked, the only thing he had been waiting around for was for this shit that was going on in the streets with corporate Amiri and the rest of those BB niggas to wrap up. Now that shit was over, and the nigga probably had already walked away from the shit and was gonna go live a boring ass life going forward. I learned from Kyrie about the killing of Amiri and a few other niggas. He told me how corporate, Chaotic, and Cody were responsible for those killings. even though that shit was just speculation because no one had any hardcore proof that those niggas did it, my nephews were the only people I knew who could pull up to a homegoing service where that nigga was paying homage to his brother and gun him and the rest of them niggas down like that. I knew that Corporate had to have been pushed to his limit because he ain't even moved like that. Corporate mainly did his killings by pulling up to a crib and airing shit out right there, but to do it all out in the open like that, let me know he meant business. The fact that I knew Corporate meant business was why I had been moving slick, because I knew without a doubt that if Corporate found me, he was shooting first and asking questions later. And with that, I needed to be alert. The only reason I wasn't bringing Kyrie with me tonight to meet with this new connect is that the shit I was doing was dangerous. I ain't had no meeting with this nigga or nothing. I was just popping up. After doing some digging, I learned that Rodriguez was the man to see. I was pulling up to one of his warehouses right now, hoping this nigga didn't blow my head off for walking into a territory where I wasn't invited. I knew for a fact that if a random nigga had walked into the Strong organization without some kind of invite, Corporate would, without a doubt, have blown their head off. A few weeks ago, I was doing some rounds and I ran into some corner boys. I asked them who they was working for and they told me that they was moving the rest of that weight for Amiri, even though the nigga was dead. Them little niggas was flapping their gums and I learned from them that their connect was this Spanish cat named Rodriguez. He only been in business for a few years, but from what they were telling me, he got pure quality shit, just like Strong has. I just want to pull up to the warehouse and prove that I can. Pops, that shit is fucking dangerous, man. You know you don't walk into a nigga's place of business where they do they fucking dirty work without an invitation. Them niggas not gonna know who the fuck you is, and they might just blow your fucking head off before you fully get on the property. Look, I know you hungry for this shit. I get it. I'm hungry too, but this ain't the way to go about it. You pulling a fucking rookie move right now, Kyrie barked at me. Just from his voice and the way it had risen, I could tell that I'd pissed him off, but I really didn't give a fuck. Wow, so that's how you feel about the nigga that gave up being loyal to the organization or the family, nigga. Your son gave up loyalty to the larger organization run by his own family. And this what you think? Told you, this nigga trash. They need to stick an M80 up his ass and light it. Mm-hmm. And leave him in that warehouse. Kyrie, what the fuck you expect me to do? We ain't making no real fucking money. I got two duffel bags in my backseat filled with money, and I can bring that shit to them niggas and show that I want to cop some weight. Now, if I showed up empty-handed with nothing to prove that I was serious about making money with Rodriguez, he would have all of the grounds to kill my ass, but that ain't the case. Chill the fuck out, and when I get back in the car after meeting with him, I'll hit you back. I snapped and hung up the phone, not allowing him any room to say anything else. Of course, what Kyrie said to me was something that I'd been thinking about, but I pushed that shit to the back burner. I need him all in my ear being negative and shit. I was hungry and desperate to get out there and make some money and run my own organization the way I had wanted to run it for years. And there's a break in the chapter. Meanwhile, at the hospital with Corporate and Pleasure. Corporate Strong. I was lying in this little ass hospital bed with my wife. She begged me to get in bed with her before she went to sleep. And as uncomfortable as I knew that shit was gonna be, I still got my ass in bed with her. She was able to get comfortable, lay her head on my chest, and after 5 minutes of being up and telling me she couldn't wait for the twins to come home with us, she eventually dozed off. I couldn't sleep these days because I'd been at the hospital with Pleasure and my babies, staying up and alternating between being in the room with my wife, making sure she was good, and checking in on the twins who were in the NICU. I was being strong for my wife because she was going through it, scared out of her mind that our babies wouldn't make it and we wouldn't be able to bring them home and do everything with them that we'd anticipated. As strong as I was being for Pleasure, the truth is, I had fears of my own. But I couldn't show that shit to my wife because I would just fuck her mind up even more. As positive as I was, there were still voices in my head trying to fuck with my mind and tell me that my babies might not make it. The way Big Mom was coming down to this hospital and praying for the twins along with the black nursing staff that was praying as well, being optimistic and telling us that our babies were going to be okay, I had faith that everything was going to work out. it had to work out. Pleasure and I had been through way too much shit this past year alone for this to be the fucked up finale that we got. I'd already ordered car seats that I couldn't wait to put in the back of the Escalade that I was going to surprise my wife with. I ordered strollers as well and a bunch of other baby items that I'd been sending to the house, giving Miss Bernice instructions to let the delivery workers come in and bring everything into the foyer. That's just how positive and optimistic I was trying to be about this entire thing. As I lay there, my phone started ringing. It was a call from Dennis, the PI that I had, trying to track down Kyle's ass. I'd been working with Dennis for well over 10 years. He'd helped me track down so many niggas over the years so I could kill their asses. I trusted the nigga, even though I felt like he was moving slow as fuck with this whole Kyle situation. I paid Dennis's ass good money, so he always came through, even though there were times when that shit felt delayed. "Yo," I answered the phone. "I see your boy. I don't even think you gonna have to pop him, to be honest. Dumbass niggas getting out of the car holding duffel bags in his hands that I'm sure is filled with money. And I know the warehouse that he's going into. That's Rodriguez's warehouse. I've done a couple jobs for Rodriguez, and I know he's not doing business with Kyle. I'm gonna stay right here, parked on the side, and let you know when those gunshots go off, because it's only a matter of time," Dennis said. I sucked my teeth a little pissed off because I wanted to be the one to pop his ass. For years, I knew that I was going to be the one to pop Kyle, but from the sound of things, that nigga was just moments away from death. On top of that, I wasn't about to leave my wife in the hospital by herself, and I didn't want to leave my babies either. I guess that shit was never meant for me to be the one to kill Kyle. For years, I hesitated on that shit, knowing it was something that my pops wouldn't have wanted, nor my grandfather and my great-grandfather. Hold on, y'all. Listen, y'all know a bitch got arachnophobia, child. Knock it the fuck off. All right, sorry. All along, the nigga was supposed to die, but I guess I just wasn't the man for the job. "Yeah, hit me back when it's done," I responded and then hung up. If there were ever any plans of me going to sleep, that shit was just tossed out the window because I wanted to get the phone call that Kyle had been popped. Y'all don't understand how fucking long I waited for that shit. Sade told me a while back that before I killed Kyle, she wanted to have his mouth swabbed so she could prove to Cody that he wasn't Kyle's son. But Cody was firm on that shit that we didn't have to do that because he took Sade's word. Now, if Cody didn't want the nigga dying until we confirmed his paternity, I would have had to tell Dennis to hit up Rodriguez and tell him not to pop Kyle. But since that wasn't the case, the nigga could walk his dumb ass in there and fall right to his death. Disrespectful ass nigga probably went in there with money from my fucking drugs that he stole from me and was gonna use that to cop some weight. I swear, ain't no way that nigga got the same blood running through his body as me. I swear I don't claim that nigga. And then there's another break in the chapter. Oh, my God. Hey, Ashley Rydell. Welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Y'all welcome Ashley Rydell to the Speakeasy. All right. Back at the warehouse with Kyle. Kyle Strong. I stood in front of the big double doors, and before I could even raise my fist to knock, it was opened, and two big-ass Spanish cats who needed to be on somebody's fucking football team tackled my ass to the floor. The duffel bags that I had in my hands were snatched away. As they had me on my back, another dude came over and started going through the duffel bags while another nigga searched me. He grabbed the Glock that I had on my hip and snatched that shit away from me. It was a bunch of Spanish speaking going on, and they were angrily looking at me like they all wanted to kill my ass. "Who the fuck are you?" one of the dudes holding me down asked. His accent was thick as fuck, and he had a crazed look in his eyes like he was gonna kill my ass right here. "My name is Kyle. Look, man, I ain't come with no bad intentions. I have those duffel bags right there filled with money, and I just want to cop some weight from Rodriguez. That's it. I ain't on no funny shit," I said, remaining strong and showing no fear because I didn't want these niggas to think I was pussy. Deep down inside, a piece of me was a little nervous, and I felt like I was just moments away from death. "Release him," another thick Spanish accent barked. Those two big niggas finally let me go, and I was able to look ahead of me. I could be my last dollar at the... My last dollar that the Spanish cat coming toward me was Rodriguez. I'd never seen him. I just heard things about him. I could just look at him and tell that he was the head nigga in charge of this operation. The walk, the nice suit, all of that about him indicated that he was the leader and those niggas worked for him. "Strong?" he asked, like he was confused that a strong man would be there to do business with a whole other plug. "Yeah," I responded. He laughed once he made it closer to me. I hadn't gotten my ass up. I was still sitting on the floor, mainly because I was looking around, trying to see which direction my ass would go if I had to make a run for it. Rodriguez looked me in my eyes, and then he looked at the duffel bags that were next to me and kicked them in my direction. It stopped right in front of my legs. "How you get that money?" he asked. "I had my guys move weight," I responded. "What weight? Where did you get it?" he asked. I didn't answer his question right away because the way he asked it was kind of like he already knew something. I would have been a fool to say that it was weight that I had stolen, so I kept quiet. My silence made him laugh, and then he stepped a little closer to me and glared me in the eyes. He had hazel-colored eyes, and I could see a lot of dark and evil in them. The glare alone that he gave me let me know that I fucked up. All I do is supply, but I work with different organizations, and they talk. I know about you, Kyle. I've heard stories about you, so I know how disloyal you've been to your family. I know how you were able to get this money in this duffel bag. You stole weight from your family and put boys on the block who used to work for your family. Do you look like the kind of man that I would want to do business with? If you can't even be loyal to your own flesh and blood, I know that you won't be loyal to me. Rodriguez was quick to pull out his gun, and he aimed that shit right at my forehead. Come on, man. I'm just trying to start up my own fucking organization. I'm sick and tired of working for them niggas. I want to run my own shit, I barked, pleading with him so this nigga wouldn't kill me. Which should have been what you decided on in the beginning instead of stealing and scheming from your own family. I'll never do business with a man who shows no loyalty to his family. You'll never be trusted, he finished. I looked down the barrel of his gun, and all I heard was, gunshots lodged into me back to back, instantly ending it all right there. I had a good run, but now my time was done, and it was time for me to join my brother, my pops, and the rest of the strong men. I hoped they'd still want to fuck with me after I'd been disloyal as hell on earth. And that's the end of that chapter. That's what I'm talking about. Light that nigga up. Child, listen. A whole ass mess. Hey, Choco Chip, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey, and thank you for bringing the good vibes with you. All right, who else I saw? There you go. Hey, Shakara, how you doing today, boo? Tell my bestie I said what's up. Ooh, my ear is itching. My grandma say when your ear itching, that means somebody talking about you. Everybody sleep around here, so I know it ain't nobody in the house. Which one of you motherfuckers talk about me? Ooh, why grandmama's got all the old wives' tales and shit. That was the end of that chapter, child. Let me get the next time stamp. Grandmas know they be having all the old wives' tales, all the home remedies and shit. Like, what the hell? How y'all remember all that shit? Hell. And y'all remember to run from the damn dinosaurs, too. Hello, Taz13. You're new. Welcome. Thank you for being here. Y'all welcome Taz to the Speakeasy. Don't cut up now, Taz. Because, child, listen. My chat box full of folks that don't play that. Hey, Summer. Welcome, boo. Happy Sunday, darling. I appreciate you being here. All right. Here we go. I got my time stamp. I'm still waiting for it to count down, honey. The first one had run on past me. All right. Chapter 20, Pleasure Strong. You good, baby? My husband asked after he'd opened the passenger side door and assisted me with getting out. Once I was out, he held on to my hand as we walked up the stairs to go into the house. I was discharged from the hospital this afternoon, but I didn't leave until about an hour ago because I didn't want to leave my babies. Also couldn't stay in the NICU with him. I cried so bad when I left the hospital because it hurt me to leave my babies. But what made me feel a little better about the situation was knowing that my babies were in good hands. I couldn't thank the nurses and doctors enough who'd been working with me. They were handling the twins with so much care that anyone would have thought that Couture and Kairu belonged to them because that's just how attentive and loving they'd been while helping Corporate and me get through this tough time. Both twins had gained a pound since I'd given birth to them, and they were continuing to fight, proving to Corporate and me, along with everyone else, that they were some little fighters. I knew it would be a long journey, but I had faith in my babies, and I couldn't wait until I got to bring them home. Okay. I'm fine, baby. Thank you. I turned around to look at my husband, then quickly leaned in and kissed him on his lips. When I say that this man had been there for me since I went into early labor, I really mean that. He hadn't left my side during this entire thing. My emotions had been all over the place, and I knew I had been a lot to deal with over the past few days, but he hadn't shamed me for being a little unbearable. He wasn't aggravated by me, and Corporate continued to tell me to get it all out of my system because he would be there helping me get through it. Physically, I'd needed him so much these days as well because I had to undergo an emergency C-section, so my body was still in a great amount of pain with trying to walk and get around, but he's been helping me. I just couldn't put into words how much I loved my husband, so I wasn't going to even try. Corporate kissed me one last time, and then he used his fingerprint to let the two of us inside the house. He pushed the door open, and I walked in first. When I saw everything that he'd managed to have done for me in the foyer, my hands went over my mouth, and I instantly started crying. Why you ain't have somebody put the shit up? Anyway, I turned around to look at Corporate, and I playfully hit him on his arm, even as I was still crying. He laughed while he wrapped his arms around me in a bear hug. There were big balloon letters, and the colors were pink and white. It read, "Congrats, Mama, times two." And there were over 100 pink and white balloons in the air that filled the entire space. A beautiful black and brown mockingbird double stroller was parked right in the foyer. It was the same stroller that I'd shown Corporate a couple of months ago, and I told him that it was the one I wanted. The matching mockingbird brand car seats were propped right on the floor, and there was a nice hot pink Chanel diaper bag next to them with beautiful baby towels and matching outfits for Couture and Cairo. There were huge flower vases on the floor. In total, it was probably 10 flower vases that were huge like that, and in each one, there were well over 50 pink and white roses. Everything was so beautiful, and I was crying so hard because I wasn't expecting any of it. I'd already told Corporate on the drive home that I wanted to shower and whip up something really quick in the kitchen for dinner, but from the smell and the sound of things, someone was already in the kitchen cooking. That just showed how zoned out I was once I'd gotten out of the car because I hadn't even seen the extra car in the driveway. Shit ain't go the way we expected it to with your labor, but I'd be a fool if I let you come home to nothing after you just risked your body like that to bring my beautiful babies into this world. I love you, P. I hope you know that. And pretty soon, those car seats and those strollers will have Couture and Cairo in there, all right? Corporate asked as he turned me around to face him. I nodded while still shedding tears as I looked him in his eyes. I wrapped my arms around his neck, being very careful to not stretch my incision, and then Corporate put his hands on my ass, giving it a light squeeze. I got lost in his lips, and the two of us started kissing. We hadn't kissed like that in a few days. For the most part, it had just been pecks on the lips, but our full tongue kissing sessions had been put on pause for a while, and it wasn't until I was having a makeout session with my man that I realized how much I missed this. Man, stop all that shit, I heard Colony say from the stairs. I pulled away from Corporate, pecked him once more on the lips, and then I turned my head to look at the top of the staircase where Colony was standing with a phone in his hands, recording us. There was a smirk on his face, which I had no doubt was there because he knew both me and his dad were going to get on his ass for cursing. One day, I'm going to pick your ass up by them fucking dreads and slam your ass. Corporate responded. Colony just laughed as he made his way down the stairs. He made it over to me and put me in a bear hug, just like his father had done. I loved this boy so much. Our relationship was only rocky for like the first 5 minutes we knew each other. Once his ass apologized for calling me fantasy, I swear we were good. Colony and I grew so much during the course of my pregnancy. I'll never forget those long hours that I would be up in the movie room with him, eating snacks, watching movies, and having deep conversations. You good? Colony asked after pulling away from me. I'm good. What were you up there doing? I asked him. Nothing. Playing the game. I'm gonna go with you tomorrow to see my brother and sister, he told me, and I smiled at his words. Colony hadn't been coming to the hospital much, and he told his father that the sight of his little brother and sister so small with all those tubes hooked up to them just kind of scared him, and he didn't like having to see them that way. I totally understood where he was coming from. As their mother, this was something that I hated to see, but I had to do it. It was crazy because I remembered when KJ was born premature and I kept telling Nene and Chaotic how strong they were. Now, there we were, years later, and I was in that same situation where I had no choice but to be strong. I went into the kitchen while Corporate and Colony went outside together so they could bring in all my gifts, flowers, and bags from the hospital. My family and friends had my hospital room looking like I'd had a baby shower with all the stuff they were bringing to the hospital each day. Jeff, the chef that Corporate used, who was also his friend, was in the kitchen. When he saw me, he smiled, wiped his hands on some paper towels, and gave me a quick one-armed hug. Jeff was cool. He and I were introduced years ago when Corporate and I first got together. I laughed because once Corporate trusted me enough to bring me over to his house years ago, he had this nice private dinner set up, and his ass lied and told me he cooked it. We had stuffed chicken, and that had always been one of my favorite meals, so I remember asking him what ingredients he used in his because it tasted so good. When the nigga started stumbling over his words, that's when I knew his ass was lying. He ended up confessing and telling me about Jeff. He called Jeff up right then, and I went on and on telling Jeff how good his food was, and we had been cool ever since. "What's up, P? My wife and I got a few things for the babies. I put the bags over there," he told me, and pointed to about 5 big gift bags. I could look at them and tell that each bag was heavy, yet he was talking about he'd only gotten a few things. I laughed and then hugged Jeff once more and thanked him for the gifts. "What you cooking?" I asked, standing by the counter, watching him go back into the kitchen and finish the meal. "Some Cajun chicken Alfredo. I know how much you like your crab cakes, so I have that too. And I'm gonna make sure to keep this right over here to the side so that Colony's ass don't get a hold of it," he responded. I laughed at his reference to the bad allergic reaction that Colony's ass had during his first week with his dad. Jeff also showed me the Caesar salad that he was preparing, and my mouth watered, anticipating the good food that I was about to have. I wanted to go upstairs and shower first because that shower at the hospital wasn't cutting it for me. Child, they are the fucking worst. Anyway, sorry. I wanted to stand under some scorching hot water and have the pressure on my favorite setting so it could beat down hard against my back. Going up the stairs took much longer than it would normally take me because my body was still in a great amount of pain, but I eventually made it to the top. I walked the long hallway until I was eventually standing in front of the nursery. Everything in me wanted to just keep the door closed and head to my bedroom because I didn't want to walk in, see all the blood on the carpet, and be reminded of the pain I had to endure a few days ago, right before I gave birth to the twins. I wanted to see inside, though, just to get some kind of inspiration that my babies were going to be in this exact room pretty soon. So I opened the door, and sure enough, my husband had shown out again because the floor was perfectly clean, leaving no trace of blood or trauma. So I stood there. And as I stood there, I just kept thinking about the phone calls that Corporate kept making while he was at the hospital. I just assumed he was handling business because it didn't matter the time or the day. His ass would forever be committed to the strong business and was going to be working. All that time, he was having things set up so this nursery could be cleaned up and he could surprise me with the beautiful gifts that he had waiting for me downstairs. Corporate hadn't been home, so the second crib that he never got the chance to finish putting together, the pieces were neatly off to the side, and I was sure he would put it together one day this week. He wanted to be able to build the crib that his babies would sleep in, and I love that. The last time I stood in there, I didn't even know what I was having. Now there I was, mommy to a beautiful little girl and a little boy. The crib that was already put together, I walked over to it and picked up the small stuffed giraffe that was inside. I held it in my hands and looked around the room for about 5 more minutes, and then I placed the stuffed animal back on the bed. I eventually left the room and closed the door behind me. I made it to our bedroom, and it was nice and tidy. I could tell that Miss Bernice had been in there. It was just a fresh, clean scent in there, and that was usually the smell that would linger after she'd been there to clean. I took a seat on the ottoman that was right in front of our bed, and I hadn't even been sitting for a full minute before the door opened and Corporate walked in. He'd removed the gray polo sweater that he was wearing before, so it just left him in a white wife beater with the gray polo sweatpants. It was so hard not to be a creep because that dick was literally leading the way as he came over to me. His handsome face held a serious look per usual as he stared at me. His waves were nice and healthy looking along with his beard. There weren't any shoes on his feet, just his white Nike socks. Once he was in front of me, he gently picked me up, being extra careful with me, and took the seat on the ottoman where I'd just been. He placed me on his lap and gently bounced me on his thigh. I turned to look at him and raised my hand, putting it on the side of his face. "I love you. I just had to let him know. I love you more, Mama," he assured me. Just as quickly as we were about to have a little moment, his phone started ringing. He had it in his pocket and he quickly pulled it out and showed me that it was Kyrie calling him. Something already tells me why he's calling. Let me just see, though, Corporate stated with his arm around my waist. He used his other hand to answer the phone and put the call on speaker. Yo, he answered. I guess you're happy, huh? Kyrie's voice came through the phone. He sounded like he'd lost his voice and it cracked a bit when he spoke as if he was crying. I didn't have a clue what Kyrie was referring to, but I knew my husband did because he had a smirk on his face. Just using my common sense, though, something told me that Kyle was probably dead. Of course I'm happy. My wife just came home from the hospital and my babies are going to be next, Corporate revealed. Corporate, don't act stupid, man. I'm sure you heard about what happened to my pops. They fucking killed him, Kyrie shouted, his voice cracking again. Well, don't nobody give a fuck, Kyrie, about you or your ugly ass daddy, little nigga. Shit, with your little disloyal ass. 1 second, y'all. All right. Corporate sat there with a nonchalant look on his face as he glared over at me. His attention was more on me than it was on the damn phone call that he was on. What you expect from me, nigga? You want me to keep you in my thoughts and prayers? Your dad was a grimy ass nigga, and it was only a matter of time before somebody popped his ass. You called a wrong nigga to be giving you a motivational talk and some prayers because you know how I feel about that nigga, and you know that the shit that I planned to do when I caught up to him. What you calling me for, though? You think I did that shit? I'll stand 10 toes down and be a man and tell you that I didn't pop Kyle, Corporate said, and I believed him. I didn't know shit about this, but I'm sure the second he got off the phone, my husband would put me up on game. I know you didn't do it. I'm just placing the call to let you know that it's been done. Look, Corporate, I ain't got no issue with you, man. At the end of the day, Kyle was my pops, and I was siding with that nigga whether he was right or wrong. I understand that what he did was fucked up, so I'm not gonna sit here and try to justify that, but you know as well as I do that if Kato were to ever do some fucked up shit, you would have sided with that nigga too. Man, do you not remember who my pops was? Kato looked like the kind of nigga to you who would have crossed his family? Corporate asked, with that vein sticking out on the side of his neck as he snapped, making it clear that just that fast, Kyrie had pissed him off. Man, all I'm saying is that we as a people tend to ride for the ones we love, even though we know they might be wrong, and Kyle was definitely wrong in this situation. Well, don't nobody care, sir. Your daddy dead. Shit, the fuck? What we supposed to do, cry? Ain't nobody giving a fuck about your daddy. I tried to talk that nigga out of meeting with Rodriguez, and they ended up killing his ass, doing exactly to him what I feared they would do. I'm sure you don't give a fuck, but I just figured that I would relay the message to you. I wish y'all well. I'm gonna get the fuck out of Miami and relocate somewhere else. Congrats on the baby and everything, Kyrie said, and he honestly sounded very genuine. The hurt was so deep in his voice. I looked at my husband, and I could see that his face had calmed down a bit. He didn't look so angry anymore. Corporate and Kyrie weren't the closest of cousins, but before all this mess, the two of them were cool. A lot of their relationship was mainly business, but they would still hit each other up from time to time just to talk. But ever since Kyle and Corporate had been beefing, none of that had been going on between the two of them. I appreciate that. Be easy and be safe wherever you do decide to go, Corporate stated, and then he hung the phone up. After that conversation, Kyrie and Corporate would probably never speak again. It just seemed so final, like that was their final goodbye. I looked at my husband with confusion in my eyes, basically telling him to explain to me when the hell Kyle was killed, how the hell he knew about it, and why did he take his ass to Rodriguez? Corporate explained everything to me, and once he was done, he pretty much answered every question, so there was nothing else to really say. When he finished, though, I glared at him, preparing myself for the next question that I wanted to ask. Hold on, pause, y'all. Here go my question. What the fuck Rodriguez and them do with the money that Kyle had in the motherfucking duffel bags? Because technically, that motherfucking money was made off of Corporate Nim's work. So it's only right that they give the money to Corporate, right? I mean, you know, with a, minus a small fee, you know, for taking out the trash for Corporate Nim. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, maybe take 50 racks, my guy. Because, I mean, y'all had a little target practice too. But, like, I need to know what happened to that money. I hope they mention that. All right. when are you going to retire from this? I asked. I'm training Chaotic and Cody because Sade and I just about had enough of this shit, but my brothers are still hungry for it. I think this year put a nigga through too much shit, and I don't love the game nearly as much as I used to. I got three other people that I have to live for now. I just want to school my brothers a little, make sure they're fully prepared for the shit that comes with running this organization, and then I'll retire. Your ass is done for good, though. No more sitting in on no meetings, going to drops, running traps, none of that shit. Take care of my kids. That's your only job, and I'll forever take care of you, baby, he said, and I playfully rolled my eyes at him. Ooh, that sounds like so much fun, I sarcastically said as I tried to stand up from his lap. He laughed, grabbed my arm, and stopped me from getting up. I watched him as he unlocked his phone with his face and went to his photos. He played a video that I didn't even know his ass had recorded. I was in the NICU with the twins, and I was changing Kairu's diaper. This was just yesterday. I'd been so scared to even touch them that I hadn't been changing their diapers, but yesterday I put my fears to the side and did it anyway. I looked to be in a zone and heavily tuned in to what I was doing, making sure I was extra careful because I didn't want to hurt them. I keep playing this video. I'm so in fucking love with you, baby. My husband gasped me, causing me to blush. The video ended and then he played it again. This time, instead of watching the video, I watched his reaction and he had so much love in his eyes. I ran my hands through his hair, looking at him with just as much love and passion in my eyes as he had for me while watching the video. Now, everything is handled and we can just focus on our little family, I told him. Nah, I got one more thing to take care of, and then we can focus on our little family, he responded. What is it? I wanted to know. Nothing too crazy, he said, and I just left it at that. Some shit was just better left unsaid, and I didn't want Corporate to stress a bitch out with whatever the hell he had to take care of. Instead, I just kissed him one last time on his lips before I stood up for real this time and went to the bathroom to take a shower. I was excited to eat some good food because I could feel my appetite coming back. I hadn't eaten anything in the past couple of days. Before calling it a night, though, I was going to call my big ma. She was still at Rhodesia's house, and we talked a couple of times today. She made me promise to call her before I went to sleep. After that, I wanted to have a nice cuddle session with my man tonight, watch a good movie, and I couldn't wait to get back to the hospital bright and early tomorrow morning to see my babies. And that's the end of that chapter. All right, now, let me see. If anybody else, let me see. Oh, okay. So Lovely Mitchell said the right ear means they talking good. The left one, they're talking bad. Okay, Lovely. Thanks for putting a bitch up on game. Because, like, you know, I just thought either ear itching, somebody was talking about you. And I guess in that case, it is correct. I just didn't know that right meant good and left meant bad. It was the right ear, child. Ooh, somebody's singing my praises, child. It was the right ear. Who talking good about me? Probably ain't nobody but Mr. Nigga talking about, yeah, Saki got some. Anyway, let me get this time stamp, child. And I'm so fucking ignorant. Oh, my God. All right. I'm putting this thing here. All right, here we go. I got it. So I got that from Lovely Mitchell. Hey, Cleopatra Boo, welcome. And you too, M. Royce, welcome. Welcome. Thank y'all for being here. I appreciate y'all. Let me see. Oh, nope. Hey, Lexi, welcome. Happy Sunday, darling. I appreciate you. Yes, yes, yes. Hey, La, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Listen. Don't pay me no mind. Don't pay me no damn mind. My goddamn cornbread is not done. I promise you that. And I'm all right with that, child. Y'all just got to come to grips with it and be at peace with it like I am. Shit, it's so much easier when you just be like, you know what? Fuck it. Right. Feel good. You should try it sometimes. All right, here we go. Chapter 21, Corporate Strong. I didn't really know if I was reaching with the shit that I was doing right now, but this was something that I knew for a fact my wife was scared shitless over, and I wasn't in the business of ignoring a fear that Pleasure had without trying to handle that shit. Ever since Pleasure had gone missing and came back, she had been talking about Amiri's mother and his grandmother and the fact that they could put roots on somebody and fuck up their life. The day she came home from the grocery store with Colony after running into Amiri's mother, I could tell that that shit had genuinely fucked her up. When she was in the tub with me, telling me that shit, I could feel the way she was shaking. Just about every other day, she was going to Big Ma and asking her to pray for her out of fear that Amiri's mother or his grandmother were plotting on Pleasure and our babies. Look, I don't too much believe in shit like that, but part of me had been questioning why that shit happened to my wife with her pregnancy. Her whole pregnancy, everything had been going pretty well. She was emotional as fuck, but at each doctor's appointment, her vitals were always good and the babies were growing and nice and healthy. That's why that shit still wasn't making sense to me, why she'd had that amount of pain, lost that much blood, and why she was in the nursery screaming. Low-key, that shit kind of shook me a bit because I never heard my wife scream my name out in fear that way. Since we'd been together, I had seen Pleasure scared on multiple occasions. I didn't know if I was letting my wife rub off on me or some shit and had me believing that Amiri's mom might have cooked some shit up that harmed my babies and made them come earlier than expected. But there I was, sitting in this bitch's room at the foot of her bed, waiting for her to come out of the shower. This house was hot as fuck, and I'd been sitting there for about 15 minutes, waiting for her to come out of the bathroom. My ass was sweating. My gun was in my lap, but I ain't planning to use it unless I really had to. My wife didn't have a clue that I was there. She was at home sleeping when I left. I left the house a little after 10 at night. Pleasure was tired because we'd been at the hospital pretty much all day with the babies. They were making progress, coming along, and that made our need for them to come home and be with us that much stronger. The bathroom door eventually opened, and a woman came out with a towel wrapped around her body. When she saw me, she jumped and she screamed, "Sit down. I ain't gonna hurt you." My voice was calm. There wasn't any aggression, none of that shit. I was talking to her like I would talk to anyone else. She was visibly shaken up by getting out of the bathroom and seeing me sitting at the foot of her bed. She had stopped screaming, but she had her hand over her mouth as she walked over to an accent chair in the corner of the room. When I looked into her eyes, she didn't have any life in them. Both of her sons had been killed this year, and from what I knew, Aiden and Amiri were her only kids, so now she was left childless. I was sure that if Sade had lost my brothers and me, she would have that same lifeless glare in her eyes as this woman had. But my mama was so fucking gangster, though, that she would have probably had a gun hiding in her towel. She would have popped a nigga so fucking fast if she came out of her bathroom to a strange man sitting at the foot of her bed. "You know who I am?" I asked, and she nodded. "Who?" I asked. "You killed my sons," she responded. I didn't kill Aiden, but at the same time, I wasn't going to just throw my wife under the bus, so I nodded, willing to take the rap for it. I stood and made my way over to her. Standing directly in front of her, I held the gun at my side. She was shaking, and I saw the fear. This woman was trembling, pretty much the same way she had my wife at home, fearing that she was going to do some shit to her, myself, and our babies. "Look, I don't know what the fuck kind of practices, rituals, or whatever the fuck you be doing in this bitch, but I'm looking you in your eyes and telling you to leave me and my fucking family the fuck alone, all right? Same way I made your fucking sons disappear, I can do that same shit to you and your mama. We clear on that?" I asked her. Yes, she responded, her voice shaking. I glared at her, thinking about what I wanted to ask her next. Just for peace of mind, I wanted to get some shit off my chest. "You had anything to do with my wife going into labor early?" I asked. A sinister smile appeared on her face, but just as quickly as that shit appeared, it left. "You took my sons, so why would I not take your son and your daughter?" this crazy bitch said. "I swear, in this line of business, kids and women have always been off limits for me, and I vowed that I would never kill either, but I could look this bitch in her eyes and see that something was mentally off with this bitch. I swear I didn't even come down there intending to kill her, but that same gun that had been in my hand, I raised it and sent a single shot to this bitch's head, killing her instantly. I ain't believing all that root shit, but she spoke on my fucking son and daughter that nobody other than family and our close friends knew that my wife and I had. It was just a chance that I wasn't willing to take by keeping her around. I let too many niggas live longer than they should have this year, and a lot of that shit had come back to bite me in the ass, so I wasn't doing that shit anymore this year. As I processed that shit, the bedroom door opened. I ain't even wait to see who was on the other side before I raised my gun and popped their ass. It was an older woman with a gun in her hands. This had to have been Amiri's grandmother that Pleasure was telling me about. She told me how both those crazy-ass bitches participated in voodoo. I had three kids now. Certain motherfuckers that I felt were gonna be a threat to my family and me, I couldn't keep them motherfuckers alive. Fucking around with these Haitians and whatever strong-ass practices they had going on, my kids weren't gonna ever leave out of that fucking hospital, so I did what the fuck I had to do. I did a final walkthrough of the house, making sure nobody else was inside. Then I quickly left. I walked over to the next block where my car was parked and got inside. After sending a picture of a broom to my cleanup crew and letting them know the address, I didn't pull out until 30 minutes later when I saw their truck pull up. Then I got the hell on and headed home. I drove with the music down the whole ride home because I needed this moment alone with my thoughts. This had been one hell of a fucking year. This shit felt like yesterday that we were outside in my backyard, moments away from starting the countdown for a new year, and I had my wife in my arms. I just knew this would be a good year, but this year had tested my gangster in so many ways. I think this was the most Pleasure and I had ever beefed. Our marriage had definitely been tested like a motherfucker this year, and no lie, after she found out about Colony, I thought she was gonna leave my ass. She came back and we settled our shit like two adults. The way she loves my son and fills in that role of being a mother to Colony while Xavier was in Atlanta was some shit that had me falling deeper in love with her ass. If I learned anything this year about my marriage, it's that I'm not always right and I have to listen to the shit my wife tells me. Huh, say that fucking shit, cause listen, and call up your brethren and let them know. Shit. For so long, I used to think that Pleasure should be happy because damn near each car that she had was six figures or more. She had millions in multiple accounts. There wasn't a designer bag or shoe that she didn't have, and she got premium dick from me on the regular. Yes, ain't nothing about that high-octane premium dick. Ain't nothing like it. Anyway. So, all of that shit should make her happy, but a nigga had it all wrong. Sometimes all my wife wanted was me, and I'd gotten so much better with that shit. I had a bond with my son that was stronger than ever. That nigga was testing me each and every chance he got, but I love Colony more than anything. He was just the younger version of myself. Then God blessed me with these beautiful twins that I had faith were going to eventually come home with us, and I couldn't wait to love on them and spoil them. Although a lot of bad shit happened this year, a lot of good shit came from this year too. At the top of the list would easily be the three kids that I now fathered. I eventually pulled my car into the driveway and went in through the gate. Y'all already know what that means once I make my way through the gate. I walked in, leaving my shoes in the garage and entered the house. I went to the bathroom downstairs, quickly hopped in the shower. Standing under the scorching hot water, I allowed it to beat down on my back as I thought about the sins that I just committed tonight while praying and asking God for his forgiveness. When I finished, I stepped out, wrapped a towel around my waist, and went over to the sink to wash my face and brush my teeth. I had clothes down there in my man cave, so after putting on some lotion and deodorant, I slipped on some briefs and pajama bottoms. The clothes that I'd worn tonight, I already had them packed up in a bag, and I was going to discard them. I never kept clothing that I used when I caught a body. I need to be reminded of my sins, so it was packed up and would be burned tomorrow. I'd already gotten the notification from the cleanup crew that the job was finished, so I went ahead and sent them their money and made my way upstairs. The first room that I walked into was Colony's. I just knew his ass would be up on that damn game, but surprisingly, he was sleeping. I laughed at this little nigga when I saw his phone propped up on the side of him, and I could see that he was on a FaceTime call with Nani, and she was sleeping as well. His ass tried to play so fucking tough, but he was in love like a motherfucker. I love Nani for him, though. I love Nani in general. I could tell that she was a good girl with a good head on her shoulders. My son needed that because her good ways would rub off on him. I admired my creation for about two more minutes, and then I walked to the nursery and opened the door. I'd finally put together that second crib, and I even put together the rocking chair. Other items were slowly coming in, and I was going to put all that shit together as well. I swear I couldn't wait for the day I would get to walk those halls and check in on all of my babies, but for now, I was going to be patient and have hope that our day would soon come. I closed the door and walked down to our bedroom where the door was cracked. I opened it and walked inside. After closing the door behind me, I went over to my side of the bed. Pleasure was sleeping. I can't even fucking talk. Pleasure was sleeping. but she had the TV on and muted. She was in the middle of the bed, resting on her side, peacefully sleeping. Since the TV was on and the light was shining through the room, I was able to get a good look at her and admire her beauty. A scarf was on her head, and she looked to be at peace by how calm she was sleeping. I kissed her on her forehead and her lips. Then I grabbed the remote that she'd left in the bed and turned the TV off. I got in bed after removing all the throw pillows that she had on my side and rested on my back. The noise I'd made caused my wife to stir a little in her sleep, so she ended up waking up, and she made her way over to me, resting her head on my chest. I ran my right hand up and down her back through the silk material of her pajama top. "You did what you had to do?" she asked after about 5 minutes of silence. "I took out Amiri's mom and his grandma," I revealed. "I didn't tell that shit to my wife yesterday because I didn't want her to try and talk me out of it. Hell, now that it was done, I could share the news." She ended up slowly sitting up since she was still in pain from the stitches, and she glared at me. "So you believe in that voodoo shit now that I was telling you about? You think they had something to do with me going into early labor?" Pleasure wanted to know. "I don't know what the fuck to believe, but his crazy ass mama knew you gave birth to a boy and a girl, so that bitch had to be in there cooking up something. Hey, anybody that I felt was going to be a threat to my family, I wanted them bitches gone. Shit should calm down now for a while. Amiri and his brother gone. His mama and his grandma, damn near all of them BB niggas and Kyle. I ain't trying to do shit but take care of my family, milk the game a little longer so that I can pass it down to my brothers and to Colony, because P, it's in him. I can't beat that shit out of him," I told her, and she nodded her head in agreement with me. "I can't believe how wild of a fucking ride this shit has been with you," she revealed. And that shit made me laugh. "Hey, we stood inside your old apartment years ago, and did I or did I not tell your ass to buckle the fuck up for this ride called life with me?" I asked her. "Yeah, nigga, but damn," she responded and playfully rolled her eyes. "We made it out together, and that's all that matters. Thank you for my kids, P. Thank you for stepping in and helping me raise Colony. A lot of niggas be too prideful to say shit like this, but I can stand 10 toes down and tell the world that I ain't shit without my wife. I need you in this motherfucker with me at all times. Life don't move the way that it should without you in it. Always remember that," I let her know, and she blushed at my words. "I can't even get on top and ride that dick to thank you for those beautiful ass words, nigga," she shot. "Heel first, baby. This dick not going nowhere," I exclaimed and grabbed her arm so that she could lay back down on me. "Good night, baby. I love you," I said with my eyes closed because I was tired as fuck. "Good night, daddy. I love you too," she concluded. And that was that. I needed this sleep. I knew that Pleasure was going to wake me up first thing in the morning, telling me that it was time to go and see the baby. So I wanted to soak up all this good sleep while I could. And that's the end of that chapter. Whoo, child. Well, I'm glad he popped a mirror. I wish he would have popped Kyle funky dick ass too, because you know what? No, sir, and no, ma'am. Mm-mm. He should have popped Kyrie's ass because he's still a threat. Like, what if one day he, you know, get gone off the Duce or something, you know, or some other fucking liquor and get to thinking about his pops and shit and forget that his pops wasn't shit. And then come up with a fucking plan to, you know, like, nigga, you don't leave no motherfucking loose ends. I'ma beat your ass.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money.
Thank you, Digi Denny, for the tip, darling. And he gonna say, "For wash your ear. Love you, Saki." Fuck you, Denny. But thank you for the tip. Crazy tail self. Shit. You know they say when your fucking ear itch, it be some bullshit. Somebody talk about you. At least it's a good thing, so I might not want to wash that ear just yet. But I got this little thing that It's got a camera on the tip end of it and a little spoon, and you stick it in your ear to, you know, get all the wax out. So I know my ear is clean, because every other day I get them out because I listen to my music loud in my headphones. And I don't know why I do that, but it just be loud enough. Like, it just don't, I don't know. Don't worry about it. Shit. I just listen to my music loud as shit. So it is what it is, goddammit, Kathleen. All right, so let me see where I'm at. All right, spoke to Taz. Got all that. Hold on. Spoke to Creole and M. Royce. Trying to see before I start this last little skippity-pap of the book. Hey, Lexi. I don't know if I spoke to you, darling, but hey, girl, hey. Welcome. I did speak to you, child. You and Petty Ass Law. Child, listen, I think about that shit every time I see Lala Anthony, because she seemed like an old petty ass bitch. I like her though, but goddamn. Chillette. Be quiet, Saki girl. I feel like Lala Anthony be on some petty shit. I don't even know. She just got a petty bitch face, right? Like, that bitch petty. So yeah, I know. Every time I see you, I think about that shit. Hey, Peanut girl. Ooh, I'm gonna finish the book, bitch, and I'm about to tell you what they was in here fucking saying about you yesterday. Honey, was you paying attention on the replay to the comment section? Girl, I'm going to tell you when I finish the book, though. But hey, girl, hey, and thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Buns. Girl, you don't stop calling me fucking Saki, I swear. But hey, girl, hey, welcome. Welcome, Buns. Gentle Leo, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. But yeah, I'm always digging in my ear with the little camera thing. The camera thing, you know, it be on your phone so you can see all up in your ear and make sure you got all the, you know, all the jive out. Y'all know I'm OCD than a motherfucker. Child, listen, my shit gotta stay squeaky clean. Even though I know you supposed to leave a little something in there, just, you know. All right, I got my time stamp. So, y'all just gotta wait while it count on down to the ground. Oh, y'all, look at the Lord. This pen has now finally... I go through about a pen a week, I promise y'all. Child, they was talking cash money shit. Girl, wait till I tell you. Here we go. Epilogue. 2 months later, pleasure strong. Aw, why you fussing? You want me to take you out of your car seat? We pulling up to the house right now, Cairo. I cooed to my healthy little man as I unbuckled him from his car seat while Corporate pulled one of my push gifts into the driveway. He'd gotten me a brand new 2023 white Cadillac Escalade with a black interior that was beautiful as hell. He said that this was my mommy car, and I loved it because the car seats sat in the middle row perfectly for my babies. The twins had finally graduated from the NICU, and they were discharged this afternoon. Y'all already know I've been crying all day because I had prayed for this moment for 2 whole months. I swear, I had a whole scenario in my head on how that day would be when I finally brought them home from the hospital, and there it was. I'd been severely emotional all day. I grabbed Cairo out of his car seat, and his little butt immediately stopped fussing. All he wanted was to be held. He'd been off and on crying the whole ride home, but he full out started screaming the second we pulled into our development. While Couture had been in her car seat, peacefully sleeping, the twins looked just alike, and my God, I was thankful for their genders being different because it was honestly like looking at the same exact baby. Couture was just always in a bow, and if you stared at her closely, you could see the small birthmark above her eyebrow, so that's another way I was able to tell the difference. Those kids were beautiful. I could kill Corporate because I had it in my mind that they would come out looking like me, but they were the spitting image of their father. I mean, down to the way Couture was so chilled and reserved, just let me know that she would even have his personality. I was holding Kairu in my arms, and my little man was a whopping 7 pounds. He looked as healthy as ever. I was in love with their chocolate skin. I begged God for beautiful chocolate babies, and that's exactly what I got. I was so in love holding Kairu in my arms and admiring him in the cream-colored jumpsuit with the matching cream-colored booties on his little feet. His hair was growing so much, so even with the small hat on his head to match his outfit, his hair spilled out on the sides. He had beautiful light brown eyes, and already he loved me so much, and he was the one that wanted me to hold him all the time. Corporate parked the car and got out. He then opened the back door and looked down at us with a smile. The front door opening let some sun shine on us, and Kairu made a face like he wanted to fight his father for doing that. Your little ass think you running the show. Yeah, I'ma have to handle you, homie. Corporate talked shit, knowing he wasn't gonna do anything because he was just as obsessed with this little boy as I was. I laughed at him while he helped me to get out of the car with Kairu. The second I was out, he kissed my lips and then Kairu on his forehead. As I held him, we walked over to the other side and I watched as Corporate grabbed Couture out of her seat. I was gushing for her, wanting to hold her too, so I cradled Kairu in one arm, and my husband knew I wanted Couture too, without me even having to say anything, so he placed her in my other arm. I cradled her, holding on to them both, just like the nurse had shown me. There I was, holding my hearts outside my body. I stared down at Couture in the same cream-colored jumpsuit as her brother, but her hat had a little bow in the front. Sister girl was knocked out, not even aware that we were finally home. Let me take a picture of this. So fucking beautiful. P, I'm about to shed tears, my husband revealed as he held his phone in his hands. I smiled for the pictures. When he was done, he reached inside the car to grab the diaper bag, and he allowed me to lead the way into the house while he was right behind me. He used his fingerprint to let us in, and the second I walked in, I was met with another surprise, just like I was surprised the day I came home from the hospital. I could tell that Corporate knew I was going to get the shit surprised out of me, which is why he lingered so close to me, making sure I didn't drop his damn kids. Welcome home! All our friends and family were standing in the foyer, some on the staircase and even in the hall as they greeted us. The decorations were just as beautiful in the foyer as they'd been when I was released from the hospital. There were balloons that spelled out Couture and Kairu, and so many gift bags were on the floor. My eyes scanned the room and went right for my big ma, who I just talked to not even an hour ago. Her ass told me that she was with Rhodesia. She didn't even try to give me a hint or anything. Aw, look at my babies. Hi, stinky man. Hi, pretty. Sade cooed, absolutely in love with her grandchildren. Without even waiting for me to give her the okay, she immediately took Kairu after she hugged me and kissed my cheek, and then she took Couture. When I say I was thankful for this woman, I mean that shit. Sade was in that hospital with my twins and me every single day. She didn't miss a damn day. She was filling shoes that my mother should have filled, and that's why Sade will always be my girl, and I'll always be thankful for her. Not only was she checking on the twins, but when I was in the hospital, she would feed me. Making sure I ate, she took my socks off and massaged my feet and rubbed my back, telling me that it was going to be okay. Sade and I had always been close and had always had a strong bond, but when I tell you that our bond was tripled from me giving birth, I mean that. And you got 5 minutes to hold him. I'm starting the clock now. You think you're the only person who wants to hold KK? Chaotic snapped, coming down the stairs to talk shit to his mother. KK is what Chaotic called the twins. I was thankful for Chaotic and Cody as well. They were some good-ass uncles, and I mean that. They had busy lives, but I mean it when I say that they would come and check on the twins every day in the NICU, even if it was just for a few minutes. They were spoiling them already, always dropping by the house with new gifts for them. All my girls were there, and I was thankful as hell for them, too. They were making sure that I didn't go through any depression by coming down to the hospital and the house to make sure I was eating and just being there for me. They all came over and hugged me, and they hugged Corporate as well. Drika, Coco, and Seth even showed up. Each of them had visited the twins and me in the hospital and were keeping in touch with Corporate and me throughout this entire thing. My girl Kennedy and Mustafa were there as well. They'd each been in attendance and a part of this journey with us too. They came over to hug me. Miss Bernice was there too because she was family, and she came over to hug me and Corporate. Next was Big Ma, who I met halfway as she walked with her cane. This woman gave me the scare of a lifetime this year with her second stroke, but I was just glad that she was still here. I didn't think she realized how much she helped me to get through my pregnancy with all the praying that she'd done for me. She would forever be my favorite girl, and I would forever give her praise for being the woman who raised me. Now, Big Ma, you know you share all the tea with me. You were supposed to tell me about this surprise, I said, after pulling away from the long hug that we just shared. She laughed and waved me off. You needed this surprise, baby. I couldn't ruin this one, she told me, as she had her hands in mine. She loved on me some more, and then Colony came over, towering over me and pulling me in for a hug. He kept his right arm wrapped around me. This was my guy right here. I loved him like I created him. He drove his father and me crazy, but that was my baby. You good? He asked me, a question that he would ask me at least 10 times a day. I'm good. You good? I asked, and he laughed at me. Long as you good, P, that's all that matters. Love you, he said. I love you more, I let him know before kissing his cheek, and he eventually let me go. Colony went over to his father and slapped it up with him. I hate that she be saying slapping it up. What these niggas slap boxing? But I know what she mean. They embraced, melting my heart. I thought this was just going to be a little surprise gathering to welcome the twins home, but our friends and family had gone all out. This was a sip and see for the twins, mixed with a baby shower, mixed with a nesting party, all of which had taken place outside. There was food, games, and all kinds of stuff for everyone to get into. Kanye was hosting, and he had everyone in tears from how effortlessly funny his ass was. Kanye knew about the death of his father, and he had yet to shed a tear over it. Their relationship wasn't a good one when Kyle was alive, and all he did was judge his son whenever he was around. So I was sure that's why Kanye wasn't moved by his death. Kanye was doing big things. We rarely saw him as much as we used to because he was always traveling for his hair services. Sanaa was up front, hosting with Kanye. My girl was in much better spirits after losing Ahmad. Man, fuck that nigga. Anyway, God, she'd gone through it with that death, but she was back to being herself. Actually, she was a much better version of herself. She didn't know what she wanted to major in, but she was enrolled in school for this semester and taken about 3 classes. She was finding herself, and her journey was so positive. I was happy for her. Look at Chaotic and Nene, Corporate nudged me. We were sitting in one of the lounge chairs outside, and I was propped on his lap. I turned my head to look at him, and Nene was sitting in one of the chairs holding Kairu in her arms. KJ was parked right next to her in his wheelchair, and she was letting him see his little cousin. Chaotic was so busy staring at Nene that his ass probably didn't see anyone else but her. I laughed, already knowing that they were back fucking around because Nene told me about a month ago. She revealed that they were taking it slow, but just from the way Chaotic was looking at her alone, I knew the nigga would propose today and marry her tomorrow if she said yes. His ass is in love. That's how you look at me, I shared, turning my head to look at him. He was so fine with that perfect lineup, those perfect waves, and that full beard, which I couldn't wait to grip tonight while we were fucking. I was more in love now than I'd ever been before. It was seeing my man in daddy mode that did it for me. Seeing him with his shirt off, doing skin to skin, changing diapers and fixing bottles were things that had me too thirsty over him. I leaned over, letting my hands go under his shirt and feeling on his abs as I stared into his eyes. You gotta chill. You won't fuck around and get 2 more, he said. And I laughed. My sex drive had just come back probably 2 weeks ago, and Corporate and I had been at it like crazy. Big Mom fussed me out so bad about 3 days ago, telling me how she could hear me from her bedroom, and I kept her up all night. Y'all know that shit was embarrassing as hell for me to hear, but to my husband, it was funny as hell. Listen, I was back popping my birth control, and my head was clear this time, so I shouldn't have any slip-ups. I wanted to at least enjoy this first year with the twins before I started thinking about having more children. Corporate, please, you love when I act thirsty, I told him, and he laughed. Hell yeah, that shit is so fucking sexy, he hyped me. I leaned my head in and gave him a kiss. We had a full makeout session out there, not giving a damn that we had guests. This man and I had been through so much, and we both deserve those kisses. I started out at the strip club and was thirsty over this nigga from the first time I saw him. That's why I came at him so aggressively. A lot of my craziest memories started from me dancing at Diamonds. Back then, I was going through a process of finding myself, so I didn't think about the bigger picture of things like kids and marriage. Diamonds was all I saw. I used to get into so much shit at that club with all those hating-ass bitches, Trix being at the top of my list. Listen, as much shit as Trix and I used to talk to each other, even I can admit that she didn't deserve to lose her life like that. She had 2 kids who needed her. Amiri proved himself yet again to be a bitch-ass nigga for killing her. I was mad at myself for even fucking around with him, but hey, that was my past, and I went through all that shit to prepare me for the amazing future that I was gonna have. I've accepted the fact that I would never have a good relationship with Rhodesia, and truth be told, I was cool with that. I would never be the kind of mother to my children that she was to me, and I swear on that. I would have to see her from time to time because there were days that Big Mom went to her house and I was usually the one who dropped her off there, but nothing would ever go past us seeing each other for the quick minute that we were in each other's presence and saying absolutely nothing to each other. That woman had issues, and I would never have a relationship with someone who continues to deny my childhood trauma. I know that's right. Fuck her. Let her die slow and painfully. Anyway, Xavier and I were cool. That's my girl. We had a healthy relationship, and she'd been calling me just about every other day, checking in on the twins. Colony was taking his senior pictures in the summer for his senior year, and she was coming down for that. We already had plans to put Corporate on babysitting duty while she and I ran the streets. All right. Before y'all get a twins, another brother or sister, Cody came over, holding a big plate in his hands filled with food. Cody and Sade had made up and were stronger than ever. They went through their tough patch, but they made it out, and that's all that matters. We all believed Sade about the DNA test that she'd taken, so we knew that Cody belonged to Kato and not Kyle. In all of this, it was Cody who needed to trust and take Sade's word, and he did because the two of them were back to being as thick as thieves. You can loosen the seatbelt a little bit now, Mama. Shit in life should slow down a little bit, Corporate told me after Cody walked away. I looked at him and playfully rolled my eyes. As long as I'm married to the Corporate Strong, I'm going to forever keep my seatbelt tightened as tight as it could go. Hell no, you won't catch me slipping, I shared, and that made him laugh. The ride was called Corporate's Pleasure. It was a fucking wild one, he revealed, and I smiled. The wildest one I ever been on. I'll do it all a million times over for you, though, I said. And then I stood up. I could see in his eyes that he was admiring my body. Because my pregnancy didn't go full term, I really didn't gain that much weight. So after I had the babies, there wasn't much weight left to get rid of. Your girl was snatched, okay? My stomach was back flat, my hips were spreading, and my ass was still poking out, having my man sit there with his tongue damn near hanging out of his mouth. I wore a nude-colored bodysuit with a pair of light denim high-waisted jeans that hugged me. My nude Hermes slides were on my feet, and my hair was styled in its signature bob. Not only did I look good on the outside, but I felt good internally as well. Where you going? I wasn't finished telling you about the ride, Corporate said, and hit his lap. Oh, I thought an eye was missing. Wanting me to sit back on it. That man was going to keep talking to me and have me escaping to go upstairs with him, trying to create the twins, another brother or sister, just like Cody said. That's why my ass was running. To go get my kids, I let him know. All right, come back, Mrs. Strong, he told me. I giggled and then skipped off to grab my babies, and I wasn't coming back. Corporate knew what he was doing. He knew it wouldn't take much sweet talking from him to have me skipping off to have sex. That man was my drug, and I'd never been addicted to any kind of drug until he came along. We'd been doing this thing called life with each other for about 13 years, and this upside-down, side-to-side, stomach-dropping ride that we were on, I could handle it, and I didn't plan to loosen my seatbelt or get off this ride with him ever. I'll forever choose to be on this roller coaster with him. And there's a break in the chapter, child. Listen. Lord have mercy. Buck, who likes to fuck? Yeah, I'm telling on your ass. I'm telling Jay all the horrible shit you said about her yesterday while y'all was in the backyard. Wait till I get through with this epilogue and don't try to fucking clean it up, pimpin', because she gonna believe me instead of you anyway. I see her, she see me, we see each other. Right, and I'm gonna tell on your ass. You better fix it. Hey, Kaylin. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you, but you got to red ball it back, boo-boo, because, yeah, that's it. It's over with. I got to finish up, you know, this little bit. Probably got about 15 minutes left, but I got to wet my mouth up a little bit. Ooh, child. Mm. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Y'all already knew what y'all was in for. Wait. There you go, Jay. I'm going to leave that up there. I say hit him in both of them. Both of them. Black both his eyes. Fuck him up, girl. Fuck him up. Yeah, I had to wet my mouth. All right, let me get back to it. All right, chaotic strong. Who the fuck texting you? I asked on some toxic shit to Nene as she walked out of the precinct with her phone in her hands. It had her attention to the point that she ain't even see a nigga standing just a few inches away from her. It was Tuesday, and I'd been texting Nene about 30 minutes ago, just picking her brain, trying to see when she was gonna take her lunch so I could pop up on her ass. She told me that she was at the precinct and she'd be taking her lunch in the next 30 minutes and going to this Cuban deli that was right across the street. There I was, squeezing some time in my day just so I could pop up on her with flowers and lunch already inside my car from the deli that I knew she was going to. I should have known your ass was up to something, Nene uttered, keeping her phone in her hand as she made her way over to me. She was in her police uniform and she looked good as hell. I'll forever live by those words that come out of my mouth when I say that absolutely nobody can rock that uniform the way she does it. The pants had a tight fit, like they were painted on her body, and the top was a little snug as well, emphasizing the tininess of her waist. She had a Glock on her waist. I could see her cuffs, and she was just all around a fine-ass officer. Her hair was pulled back into a low bun, and there wasn't a lick of makeup on her face, just some lip gloss that I could see. Even with a bare face, her face card would never decline, and she would forever prove that she didn't need makeup to be fine as hell. I'm always 10 steps ahead of you, baby. I responded and handed her the flowers, which she sniffed, smiled, and held in her hands. Thank you, Chaotic. You know how I feel about your ass popping up at my job, though. She responded. Ain't got no proof that I sell drugs. What's good? How's work? I asked, quickly changing the subject. Back when Nene and I first got together, I used to stay popping up on her ass, and she hated that shit. She felt like I was gonna get her in trouble for being affiliated with me, but these people didn't have any hardcore proof that I was moving dope, so we were good. It's good. That was pleasure texting me a video of the babies. Look at them. I'm so obsessed. As soon as I get off, I'm going to pick up KJ so we can go and see them. Nene cooed, showing me her phone. Couture and Kairu were both lying on their backs on one of their play mats, and just like any time I saw them, I swear my heart melted. They were some beautiful-ass kids and would give anyone baby fever. You sound like you want one, I responded, grabbing her hand as we walked through the parking lot to my car. She laughed and playfully rolled her eyes at me. I won't let another nigga baby mama me. I want a ring and a wedding before I go popping out another nigga's baby. Her smart ass said, shit, say less, I responded. At that point, it really wasn't a secret to anyone that Nene and I were back fucking around. I wouldn't say that we were in a relationship right now because I was still earning her trust and proving myself, which was understandable because I really did hurt her before when we were together. Although our shit didn't have a title, I wasn't fucking with nobody else and I knew she wasn't either. The second I felt like I'd gained her full trust, I was gonna take this shit up a notch and propose. The way I saw it, there was no purpose in being immature about the situation and settling for just a relationship with her. The fact that this woman even gave a nigga another chance was all the reason I needed to be a man and propose. I knew I could be good to Nene because I wanted my family and I wanted to make our shit right. I was getting older and certain shit had to start changing. My ass didn't even be in the club like that no more. When my brother would hit me at night, I didn't even answer the phone for his ass because I already knew why Cody's ass would be calling. I was slowing down on my weed and alcohol intake too. Bruh, if you tell us one more time that you don't even be smoking weed and drinking like that no more, I am gonna fucking rip each and every fucking hair on my body out of the follicles. God damn, nigga, we get it. You don't smoke weed that much and you don't be going to the club no more and you don't drink no more. Oh, whining ass. Sorry. I had just been grinding with the business because I could feel it in my gut that Corporate and Sade were getting ready to step down and pass the torch to Cody and me. So I wanted to get myself mentally. We reached my car, and I opened the passenger door for Nene, then closed it behind her once she was in. I went ahead and got inside, sitting in the driver's seat. No, we thought you were getting in the trunk, for fuck's sake. Sorry. I started the car, and because a nigga was so paranoid about sitting in the parking lot of a precinct, I drove out of the lot and went across the street to a plaza where I parked in the back. By that time, Nene had retrieved her food in the back and was about to dig into her sub. The whole time she did that, I had my eyes on her, obsessively staring. "What, chaotic?" she asked, and I laughed. "Damn, I can't look," I questioned, and she giggled while shaking her head. "I just really can't believe that I'm back fucking with you. That dick put me under some kind of dumbass spell," she said. "Nah, you just believe a nigga when I say that I've changed. We good, right? Don't I be making you happy?" I asked. "You do. I fear when the expiration date comes for all of this, though," she responded. "Ain't no expiration date. I'ma continue to treat you good," I let her know. "I'ma hold you to that. I'll kill your ass with your own damn gun, chaotic, if you fuck around on me," she threatened, right before she took a big bite of her sandwich. "We ain't gotta worry about that. I swear, we locked in," I told her. Nene glared at me, and then I motioned with my finger for her to come here. She finished chewing her sandwich down a bit, and then she leaned in and we kissed. "The next time y'all hear from us, we gonna be engaged. I promise you that. I'm getting myself together so that I can be a better man. Life is too fucking short to be fucking around. I had plenty of years to be out here running through hoes, being reckless, and making dumbass decisions when I could have been settled down with Nene because she'd always been the woman I wanted. I hadn't heard from Tanisha. A little over a month ago, I was out with Cody and my niggas chilling at a lounge, and I saw her there with some nigga. We looked each other dead in the eyes and didn't speak, and that's how I wanted shit to be every single time we saw each other. Nobody could speak on my child and expect to be cool with me afterward. I wished her ass the best, and that was all she was gonna get from me. Nobody ever saw Kyrie again, but he still kept in contact with my uncle Keanu. We learned from him that he'd moved out to Cali. They say he has a girl out that way. I wish that nigga well. Kyle's ass was finally out the fucking picture, and I was sure the only people who would miss his ass were Kyrie and Keanu. Shit had been so quiet lately. No beefing. We weren't pulling up on niggas and killing them. None of that. It was just business out here and making money as it should have been. I couldn't even call what was going on right now the calm before the storm because we'd been getting storms all fucking year, so this was the calm after the storm. The Strong organization was still going on, running smoothly and finding new ways each and every day to make this one of the biggest drug rings to ever come out of Miami. I was the brother that they felt was too immature and wasn't serious enough to run it, but lately, I'd been on my grown man shit. My brother had me on his side, training a nigga because pretty soon this shit would get passed down to me and I had to run this business well, just like the niggas and the most gangster woman to ever run the Strong organization had done before me. And that's the end of his section, because there's a break in the chapter. Oh, fuck. I said I was leaving that disrespectful ass shit. Oh, shit. I'm going back up to Buck, because he said, yeah, I said it. That's what I'm saying. He stood on business with that shit, 10 toes down, minus the big ass teeth. All right, Buck. That's right. Be a man about your shit. All right, Colony Strong. Damn, Colony, turn that shit up, my pop said from behind me. He was in the kitchen fixing himself a sandwich. The TV was on the news, but I was so zoned out holding my little sister in my arms with my phone camera on her, taking a video that I would keep saved to my phone. I didn't post my little sister or my brother on my social media because it was a bunch of fucking weirdos out there, and I ain't want to expose them to the world. Well, thank you, Colony, for being a good big brother. Because folks be out here, you got to post a baby fresh out the fucking oven. God damn. Let the nigga stop stinking first. Damn. I had a lot of followers on social media. It had been that way for a few years. The bitches loved me, and whenever I posted pictures of myself, they would go viral. I had well over 100,000 followers on my Instagram, and I wasn't going to share my brother and sister with them. I never thought I would see the day that I would be a big brother because Xavier made that shit clear that she wasn't having any more kids. My pops came through and saved the day, and now I was a big brother to a beautiful little girl and a little boy. Couture was so cool. I swear, this little girl didn't cry or anything. Just give her some milk, a nice place to lie in, keep her diaper dry, and she was cool. I liked to have her in the room with me, propped up on her little support pillow while I played the game. She would just be vibing, not giving anyone any problems. Now that fucking Kyrou, I don't deal with that little nigga. All he wanted was pleasure, and his crybaby ass cried all damn day just wanting to be held. Even right now, Pleasure was sitting right next to me on the couch, and she dozed off with Cairo on her chest. He was knocked out, sleeping in the very position that his little ass liked to sleep in. If my pops came over here and saw that Pleasure fell asleep with Cairo on her chest like that, he would snap because he hated when she did that shit. He felt like she was the reason his ass wanted to be held all the time. We're live on the scene this afternoon where a school shooting just took place, leaving one teacher, Miss Roy, dead. From what we know, several students were injured. The suspect is Brody Miller, who's a senior at, I told y'all that shit, man. That school tried to sit up there and say that I was lying when I heard that cracker in the locker room talk about how he was going to shoot up the school. They need to personally call and issue an apology to me. I was hyped as I shot up from the couch. My loud voice caused Pleasure to jump up from her sleep, and she quickly clutched onto Cairo while looking at me like she wanted to kill me. I was holding Couture in my arms, who had an annoyed expression on her face, looking just like her mama. My bad, little ma, I said to her, and then I focused my attention back on the TV screen. Sorry. Well, I never thought your ass was lying. I just thought you made a foolish-ass decision by not saying anything. Give me my son, man, before he slips out of your hands. Well, I gotta tell you this shit every day. My pops came into the den area, set his sandwich down, and took Cairo from Pleasure. Corporate move, damn, she snapped at him. He laughed while he stood there holding a sleeping Cairo in his arms while we all paid close attention to the TV screen. They were live at my old school, and Brody had made good on the threat that I talked about in court, which my old school swore my ass was lying about. Y'all need to sue them cocksuckers. Anyway. It was crazy how he killed Miss Roy, though, all because of a bad damn grade that he received in her class. Good, they killed his ass, my pop said, taking the words right out of my mouth. Why was he so damn angry like that? Pleasure wanted to know. Nigga was weird. They used to bully him, too. He was really hard on himself about his grades. He made it seem like his daddy didn't play that shit. Miss Roy was annoying as hell, but damn, he ain't have to kill her, though. The day I overheard him in the locker room, it was her who he was mad at for the grade that he'd received in her class. Shit crazy, I said, shaking my head as I watched this shit unfold. Oh, my God. Hold on, y'all. All right. I almost want to homeschool your ass. The twins, too. School is supposed to be the place we send our kids to be fucking safe. We got these crazy ass crackers going into these schools and killing people because of the fucking problems they got at home. My pop snapped, taking a seat on the couch. As he held on to Cairo, he used his free hand to wrap around Pleasure, and he pulled her his way. Homeschool my brother and sister, but you not homeschooling me. This is my senior year. I done made me a few homeboys, and I'm trying to be all in the action, I admitted. You just make sure your ass is in action with them textbooks, too, partner, my pop shot. I hear you, and the second I walk across that stage, I won't end on the family business, I said. Pleasure rolled her eyes when I said that, and my pop sucked his teeth. Hey, what I told you, nigga. Don't talk to me about that shit until you graduate. I ain't playing when I say that shit, he snapped. I hear you, I responded. And you need to put him in his playpen. You be quick to yell at me for holding them all day, and you turn around and do the same thing, Pleasure snapped at my pops. P, I'll hold him for a little while, but you walk around holding Cairo all damn day. It's a difference, he uttered. She waved him off and stood up. Where you going? He asked. To check on Big Ma and then take a nap. I'm tired, she told him. Don't go to sleep yet. I'm gonna lay Cairo down and Couture just fell asleep, he shot. I shook my head while groaning because I already knew what this nigga was trying to insinuate. Hey, man, I want to put my room downstairs. I'm right down the hall and I'll be hearing all that shit, man. I know that's how my son feel, because that's what he said. Like, Mom, God, why you gotta be so loud? Shut up, nigga. It's my house. The fuck? Anyway. All right, so what I say? I'm right down the hall, and I be hearing all that shit, man. I snapped, dead-ass serious, and my pops was cracking up. Put your headphones on, son. That's that good loving I be giving to your stepmama. You young niggas don't know shit about that, he boasted. I just waved him off. Pleasure went ahead and left the room, so it just left me and my pops down there, and each of us had a twin in our arms who was knocked out. I took a seat next to him on the couch, and I was back to admiring Couture. "Don't get no ideas, son. I'll kill you if you make me a granddad right now," he threatened. "You ain't gotta worry about that. I got too much work to get done to be having kids right now. I promise you that," I said, and reached my hand out for a pound. He did just that and sat up a little to give me a quick hug. "Love you, man." He was never afraid to let me know. "I love you too." And that was that. This was my life. I was staying my black ass out of trouble and just vibing these days. The countdown was on for the last day of school. Summer was almost here, and with that, I was going to spend the last half of it in Atlanta so that I could be with Xavier, my girl, and my niggas. Once the break was over, I'd come back to Miami. At first, I was angry as fuck at Xavier for shipping a nigga down to Miami to be with people I didn't even know. Now I swear this was the best thing that Xavier could have ever done for me because I gained so much out of this shit. I had a pops that I knew loved me more than anything, some cool-ass uncles, the best stepmother that anybody could ask for. My grandma was so fucking cool and gangster. I loved me some Big Ma, and now I had a little brother and sister, so I was happy here. My relationship with Xavier had grown so much, probably the best our relationship has ever been, so this was what we needed. Miami was the best move for me. I had a little fuck-up when I brought that gun to school and caught that charge, but I was thankful for Alicia and how she fought for me. I was still doing community service. I wasn't going to weekly meetings, but I would take that over having to do some jail time any day. Shit between Nani and me was still going well. That was my baby, and I couldn't wait to see her in a few weeks. My girl and I had plans, and once our senior year came around, she would put her application in at UM, and we both had high hopes that she would get accepted so all this long-distance shit could come to an end. I wanted to eat with my niggas from back home, so the plan was to put them niggas on once my pops put me on. The only thing is, my niggas from back home could be a little reckless, and with this being a family business, my pops was not going to allow anyone to come in and fuck with the legacy. I found myself preaching to them niggas, telling them how they had to clean their acts up a bit if they really wanted to make this money. My pops was always telling me that I was in a rush to grow up, so I was going to enjoy these last couple of weeks of school and enjoy my summer break. Once school was over, my pops was talking about having us all go to Cali for a week because he wanted to finish up business there with his enterprise and have it up and running by fall. I was going to take my senior year one day at a time and not rush shit. But I'm telling you, the second I graduated, it was go time. I wanted my pops to milk the game and give it to me because I wanted to be everything he was when it came to this hustling shit. That shit was in my blood. And even if Xavier had never decided to do the introductions, I was bound to hustle because I started hustling at a young age. I know this wasn't the route that my pops, Xavier, or Pleasure wanted for me, but I'm my father's child, and just like the name Corporate Strong had been ringing bells in the streets for years, it was only a matter of time before the world knew about Colony Strong, and I was going to be running shit too. And that's it, y'all. So, there's a note from the author, but it don't even really matter. So I'ma read it. Fuck it. It's all a part of it. It says, a note from the author. I hope you all enjoyed this series as much as I did. Going into this series, I told myself that I wasn't leaving any room for a spinoff and that I wanted to just wrap this storyline up in three parts. But these characters kept growing on me and they had so much of a story to tell that it was going to be way more than just three parts. I know everyone's going to be interested in finding out where things are headed between Chaotic and Nene, and some are even interested in seeing where things will go with Colony. He's hungry for the streets, just like my strong man. And I'm sure we're all intrigued to see just what kind of hustler he'll be. There's still so much to learn about Coy and O'Shane as well. With that said, yes, there will be a spinoff, but what I will say is I want to give it some time. If you know my writing style, I don't like to jump into the spinoff right away because I want to allow myself some time to miss the characters, and I would want the same for the readers in return. In the meantime, I'll keep you all intrigued with other amazing books that'll hold you over while we wait for this spinoff. I hope you all enjoyed this series, and as always, thank you for your continued support. Well, child, you welcome, but shit, how long a bitch got to wait for the motherfucker spinoff? Because look here, pimp, once I'm done reading, baby, bloop, on to the next. So, yeah, it's like that, pimping. Fuck a duck in the butt. I was trying to remember what it was I said. Hold on. No, not that one. I don't even know why I, I'm supposed to be fucking just, letting the randomizer do it, but my stupid ass sitting up here, every time they pick one, I'm like, not that one. Not that one. Not that one. Little fat head ass. Girl, pick one. Hold on. Because I knew I had one in mind that I said. I'm coming, y'all. Just hold on. Quit tripping, pimping. Y'all just hold on here. Somebody was trying to tell me something about some Kasem brothers, because that one keep jumping up to the top, but I can't remember what the fuck y'all said about it, so I keep passing by that one. Like, let me just cool out for a minute. I kind of wanted to switch up this nigga a light-skinned nigga too, I think, if I remember correctly, that wrote this book. I think it's a two-part. I don't know though. All right, let me keep on going first. Let me let it do another one. Ooh, chili. Oh, this one made me think about Denny when somebody sent that one, from a pastor to a plug. Oh, this other book here got about 37, 38 fucking, I'm not fucking with that one. Yeah, it's a lot of these. It's a family thing. So, yeah, anybody that's here, that was the end of the book, y'all. That's it. So if you're new here, this is the part where I fuck around and pick the next book, right? So that's what I'm doing. I'm waiting for this fucking thing to to pick a title that stand out to me. And I don't feel like reading this book, because this is one about, I think this girl be getting beat up or something. I'm not trying to fuck around with that shit, bro. I don't want to hear that shit. I don't want to read about nobody getting beat up. I wouldn't mind a fucking, you know what? Oh man, I forgot how many books is in that thing. I want to read a book that is a standalone, right? So that we're not locked into wait. I remember seeing this. Okay, I forgot which one of these motherfuckers come first. All right. Okay, so let me hold on, y'all. I'ma just get fuck. All right, so I think what we're going to do is this one. Come on, stop fucking around. All right, so let me give y'all the synopsis, because I have no clue which book comes first, but it's two books in this little series. And let me just tell you why I'm calling it a series, but the hole you dig is each one is a standalone. Okay. They're short. They're very, very short. All right. So fuck it. I'ma just where's the fucking synopsis of the bullshit? Hello. Hold on, y'all. Okay, so the red one is first. All right, here we go. It's a short one, so I'm probably going to do both of them real in the fucking, you know, real fast. It's real fast, y'all. All right. All right, so it's called The Hotel Celeste, Room 238. All right? This book is a standalone. The mysterious Hotel Celeste prides itself on privacy, first and foremost, then luxury, isolation, opulence, and anonymity. 5 floors of the most luxurious suites in the world, the Hotel Celeste hosts the uber rich, the highest paid celebrities, the most successful business moguls, and the uber rich. Yes, gotta say that twice, uber rich. And we all know the uber rich means the uber decadent. It means the uber debaucherous. It means the uber underbelly of the beast. The hotel's quiet appearance is only an appearance because everything you can think of is going down at the Hotel Celeste. All right, so room 238. Elias Brookstone, nicknamed Stone, has been a bouncer and a bodyguard in San Angeles for several years. He got the hookup with Picasso, a famous club owner, serving premium drinks, fine dining, and top-shelf cocaine. Stone signs on as an employee with Club Picasso and quickly learns his job entails a whole lot more than his previous gigs. He becomes a transporter. What does Stone transport and to where? To find out, pack your suitcase, strap in, and head for the Hotel Celeste, where money buys a whole lot more than a luxurious, expensive suite. Right. It might have been where Peanut was, child. Listen. Oh, shit. So, yeah, y'all. It ain't. So, I'm going to put. I'm going to put both books together because, yeah. Otherwise, what's the fucking point? So remember, the red one comes first. Somehow that came out really wrong. But anyway. All right. So let me go to the other one because it keeps saying all of the books. All of the books are a standalone, but girl, just come on and give me the other fucking book, ho. Goddamn, you ain't never done this shit before. All right, so now here's the fucking you dig for this one. Where the fuck is it? Oh my God, I'm about to kill everybody. Girl, it ain't even telling me about the second part. So it ain't telling me what go on in room 146. But so we got 2 rooms to read about. Room 238 and room 146, okay? It's just a quick little skippity-pat. And yeah, we're going to fuck around and find out. Because I need to know what be going down at these motherfucking hotels. You heard me? That's what I need to know. So we're going to start off with room 238. And then we're going down to the other level, to room 146. All right. So I don't know what happens in room 146, but they told us what the fuck happened in room 238. So there we go. I don't know. So now we got our shit. Okay. We know what we're reading next. And I'm excited. Ooh, child. And y'all, it's still light outside, even at 7:09. I didn't even get to go to bed, child. I didn't go to bed till about 9 o'clock this morning, child. Oh, my God. Just running my mouth and talking shit. Right. You know. Stuff that girls do. You know how girls do. We just be talking. About what? Everything. That's it. Just a little bit of everything. All right, y'all. So listen. You don't like the fast time? I like it because it's still daylight. And child, it's 7:09 down here. Yes, God. Normally, it would have been 6:09. Hell, yesterday it got dark early as shit. But look at today. Look at this one. Talking about facts. Just in case I need to book a room. Your ass. Oh, my God. Not was this some long peen in there. Oh, my God, wifey. What is with, what is with you and the long peen, girl? I cannot with y'all. Y'all some freaks. I ain't mad at it, though. Do what you gotta do. Not a skylight blue at 8:10. What happened? Skylight blue at 8:10. Oh, so okay, so it's 8:10 where you are, and the sky is still blue, it's light blue. Okay, yeah, I like it. And I would prefer it like when it's the middle of the summer and it'd be fucking 8:30 and the sun still be beaming. Yes, I like being outside then. The skeeters be getting ready to wake up to come and get you, and that's when I dip inside the crib. No God. Because I don't do skeeters. I really don't. Saki, what about Pastor Z Pussy 2? I thought you were going to read that one. I never said I was going to read that. No, I never. Denny, your ass always. Oh, my God. I never said that, sir. No, God. No. Lord have mercy. And the way, and what's his name? Quan Mills wrote that shit with his weird ass and gonna put made it P-W-U-S-S-Y. Y'all listen to the synopsis for this dumbass shit that Denny trying to get us to read. Hell, y'all weird niggas might want me to end up reading this shit any fucking way. All right, so let me read it. Read the synopsis for this weird book. All right. It says, Nashauna Nunu Spearman, a local Chicago native. Oh, Lord. It's in fucking, yeah. Oh, my God. All right. Lives her life by one simple motto, use what you got to get what you want. She's a certified bad bitch that knows how to use her honey to make money. But when her one No, but when, yeah, when her one of her many, what? But when her one, this is telling me what's going on. The pussy got bugs in it or something, because I can't even read the fucking shit in the synopsis, child. But it says, but when her one of her many honey money-making plans falls through, she suddenly finds herself having to life normally for once. I think they meant live. But I ain't gonna fuck with it. That's what they wrote. The prospect of prison forces her to take a plea deal that requires community service. That's how she ends up in the company of a popular South Side of Chicago pastor who's also running for mayor of the city. One thing leads to another. Nunu finds herself scheming and scamming once again. But will her plan backfire? Find out more in Pastors Eat Pussy 2. Lord have mercy. Listen. I know it's going to be disgusting because it's Quan Mills, the same nigga that gave us Old Thought Next Door. So just look forward to raggedy ass fucking sex scenes, child, that probably would only be appealing to niggas in prison, but okay. Oh, my word. All right. Yeah. So that's and you know there's a, y'all know he wrote another book, y'all. And do you want to know the name of it? It say, this nigga got a small dick. I am done. How about that? Lord, listen to this shit. Pregnant by my daughter's boyfriend. Girl, if you don't sit your raggedy ass down somewhere, ho, Lord have mercy. Now you know I want to know what's to this shit. Oh, it's a whole series, child. How many fucking things is it? Oh, it's the whole you dig. Okay. Girl. Lord have mercy. All right. So this one, I'm just reading y'all the synopsis. Y'all know how we fuck around over here after we get through. Even though I got shit to do. It says, pregnant by my daughter's boyfriend, the complete series. First Lady Patrice Mahoney was the epitome of a good woman, a great wife, mother, and pillar of the community. Her positive qualities diminished the moment she witnessed her husband's devastating betrayal. However, because their marital foundation was supposed to be solid, she agreed to work on the marriage. Patrice believed nothing could be worse than seeing her husband with another woman in the throes of passion. But her way of thinking is corrected when her daughter introduces her to her boyfriend's parents, people that Patrice knows all too well, people that she prayed she'd never cross paths with. Again, with fresh wounds still healing and old wounds reopened, depression and anger guide Patrice's steps while she savors the taste of revenge on her tongue. Payback season has arrived, and Patrice decides that everyone who's ever hurt her will feel her wrath, even if it means hurting her innocent daughter. Wow. Yeah. I am tripping. Tripping. So what y'all think? She talking about, please say it again. No, no, no. I'm not saying again. Pastors eat punani too. That's what it's called, sucker. Ain't nobody dumb around here. What the fuck? Try that on a bitch who graduated Cheerio University. Not me. Okay, the fuck. Yeah, I mean, it's funny. That's what I'm saying. Like, I hate it. No, Kalinka. So wait, Shakara says, Saki, I told you that the post of Old Thought was going viral on Twitter. Is that where that was from? What you showed me? Girl, I don't even be fooling around over there since they let that word nigga take over. I just go over there, drop my little thing off, and I ain't even been doing that, y'all. I really don't. They sold it to the weird nigga, and yeah, I ain't gonna be able to do it, man. That dude got problems, yo. I mean, he is just determined to be a one-man band all by his fucking self. He got money to blow, but even though he got money to blow, why are you fucking, this nigga trying to go to Jupiter and Mars and I don't know what the fuck is wrong with him. I'm like, sir, what is your malfunction? Sit down somewhere. Damn. So anyway, child, I wonder if I can click on the thing that you sent me and find it, but I'll do that later. Anyway, y'all. So yes, I have already picked what we're going to be rocking with. We're going to do a quick little skippity-pap of those two books tomorrow. And then, we'll get the fuck out of here. I'm hoping that, what is going on here? I'm gonna see if it's more pieces to this thing, because each thing is really short. No, Kaylin. I'm like, No. So wait, Kaylin, you said let's read that last one. You talking about the one about the girl with her boyfriend's daughter? I mean, with her boyfriend, with her daughter's boyfriend, her boyfriend's daughter. That's the one you're talking about? Right, let his ass get lost in space. Absolutely. Wait, what'd you say? Saki make you feel like you're in a film. Lord have mercy. Y'all silly. I'm serious, y'all. I really want to... I'm gonna look and see if it's more from the Hotel Celeste. Because I guess each thing in there is a standalone. So I wonder if there are other little, you know, I got a feeling I'm going to like the Hotel Celeste, honey. I think I might like that shit. I don't know. They got all that. Maybe, you know what? I hate when people start a good little something and then don't do nothing with it behind that. You probably had a whole fucking thing and you could have really done a good something with it and you didn't even do it. Just bullshit. All right, y'all. This was fun. Honey bears. All of my sippers and speakers. Not pastor gotta, a pastor's gotta eat too, Craig. Girl, listen. I ain't paying no damn attention to you, child. Yes, they do have to eat. She said, honestly, I would listen to all of them that you just read. Oh, my God. It really don't even matter to me. Okay, all right. So you just here for the reading. You don't give a damn if I'm reading the ingredients on Campbell's soup. Duly noted. All right. That's what I'm talking about. She just here for the ambiance. I like that. That makes me feel good. It does. That makes me feel good. All right, so I'm going to let y'all get the fuck on up out of here, child, because them households has got their little reunion. It's not, no, that's the medicine bitches. They got the reunion tonight, ain't it? Mm-hmm. I think tonight... they supposed to drag Apollo's ass out there. If Apollo was a dark-skinned nigga, Lord have mercy. But, yeah, I don't do light-skinned niggas. I ain't gonna be able to do it. I mean, it ain't for me to do it. I'm just saying, like, he's handsome, but I don't like getting no, you know, I don't feel nothing for the bruh. Nothing. But, if he was dark skinned, shit. Yep. Mm-hmm. He could get it. He really could get it. Okay, bye, lovely. Thank you for being here again. I appreciate you. Yeah, 8 is the medicine women, but the Potomac bitches are on right now. No, no ASMR. No, God, you got me fucked up. No, that I'm not. No, ma'am. Mm-mm. I do enough of that shit off of YouTube, child. Stay out my goddamn business. So yeah, I'm not doing that. No, ma'am. No, ma'am. No, ma'am. All right, y'all. So listen, I'm going to get ready to get the fuck out of here and let y'all have y'all evening back. All right? Y'all, I hope y'all had a great Sunday. I love y'all. Y'all get prepared. Lay out your outfits for school and work tomorrow. All right? Or wherever it is you have to go tomorrow, lay your shit out so you can wash your nuts and your coochies and go to bed and get up nice and early tomorrow and do it again and then get dressed and get to where you got to go on time. I want y'all to start getting to these places on time because I'm sick of it. Your boss is coming over here to the speakeasy, day drinking and shit and complaining about y'all, and I'm over it. Right. So, I love y'all. Y'all have a good night, okay? Thank you, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire, for all of your wonderful, wonderful work. I truly, truly appreciate you. Y'all don't eat too much dinner, okay? But eat enough so you don't wake up in the middle of the night. Have a great night. And if y'all do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Oh my God, listen, I'm sorry. Listen, it's this show. It's this show. I think it airs regularly on WeTV. But you can also, if you have if you have All Black, and it's called Bougie Bitches or something, child. But anyway, that's Bold and Bougie. That's what it's called. Listen, there's this girl on there that I love. I forget which show it was that I encountered her, but she was on a show a long time ago, and her name is Gaucher. She does hair, and she owns salons and some other kind of businesses she has, and I think a restaurant and an ice cream shop or something. Baby, episode 2. Right around between the 20 and the 24 minute mark, that goddamn girl comes sliding down her fucking stairs. And the way she bounced down them goddamn stairs, baby. Oh my God. And then she pop up like a nigga in the box and be like, I think that's her daughter that comes around and says, "What was that?" And because her mama is standing up, she don't realize that she fell down the stairs. So Gaucher gonna just wave off like nothing. I said, oh my God, the way her ass bounced down them fucking stairs. I know little mama was hurt later on that evening, child. That's one of them hurts that creep up on you. You like, okay, I didn't break my neck. I might have broke a nail or two, but you know, I'm still good. My shit's straight. I'm well put together. About 3 hours later, the pain seizes your ass and you be like, what the fuck? Right. Yeah, that's that sneak up on you pain. That lady, and fucking All Black ain't shit. If you hit the fucking back button, it's only going to go back to 10 seconds because that's all it takes. You see her walking and she hits the stairs. You don't see her when she first start walking down the stairs. She don't fall down until she go down like maybe the first... I can see it in my mind, y'all. She make it down the first few stairs and then maybe her foot slipped from under her or something, but she bounced down the rest of them fucking stairs like a fucking rag doll, yo. Oh my God. And I promise you, they put that shit in the motherfucking trailer and I was like, oh yeah, gotta watch this show. I didn't know what episode that shit was gonna happen in, but because I like everybody that's on the cast except for Usher's ex-wife, Tamika Raymond, that bitch is fucking annoying. Somebody gonna punch that hoe in her fucking face because she's a weird bitch. Anyway, and people make excuses for her. Ma'am, let me tell you one goddamn thing. You can be direct and you can be blunt, but you don't have to be dismissive. There's a big goddamn difference. I'm direct and quite blunt, but I'm not dismissive. That motherfucking bitch is she is an unhappy ass bitch. She's fucking miserable. And for her to be her big age, she's the elder in the group, y'all. Out of all the ladies, she's the eldest, and she is just as dismissive. I don't even fucking understand it. It's Tamika Raymond, it's Gaucher, it's Princess, producer Princess is her name, her, you know, what she's known as. She was the producer that came up like with the whole idea of Real Housewives of Atlanta, right? That's literally where she cut her professional teeth at. And so it's her. Who did I say? I said Tamika, Gaucher, Princess, Malaysia Pargo. Who the fuck else? Neo's ex-wife, Crystal. And I feel like it's another motherfucker I'm forgetting, child. this other person, but I don't think she's actually really a part of the cast, y'all. But the whole show is, to me, you know, I mean, it's a, you'll like it if you like, you know, those kinds of shows. But the whole show basically is, I guess, to give them all an opportunity. But I feel like, yeah, Tamika doing too much. I'm going to keep watching just because, yeah, I like Malaysia. I like Gaucher. I don't know. I felt some kind of way about Crystal at first, but I'm kind of coming around on her. But that was all old shit from back in the day regarding how I felt about the way she busted up, or I thought that she had something to do with Neo and Moneta, you know, being busted up, right? And I think that Neo is a pillhead bastard for the way he did her, because he made her have her fucking tubes tied. Talking about he ain't want no more motherfucking kids, right? But he wasn't your husband, boo. So why the fuck did you tie your tubes for a nigga that you wasn't married to? Your body, your choice, but okay. Then he fucks around and starts fucking around with Crystal, and they get married. And what does she do? Have babies for him. So yeah, I think that's a, you know, that's a trash bag nigga ass move, but you know, that's what they do, right? So you know, I felt some type of way about her, but I tell you what, the way Moneta smiles with the man that she's married to, he's a white guy. Yeah, I don't think that you know, she got any reason to feel any kind of way about Crystal. That lady looks happy to me, you know. I don't know. So like I said, I feel like, you know, you could really block your own blessings sitting around pining for some shit that once was. You know, the universe can't put nothing new in your hands if they're tightly closed, trying to hold on to some shit that don't mean you no earthly good, right? So yep, she's happy, married, doing her thing, and where are Crystal and Neo? And I'm not, you know, it's just this. If I don't know anything else, I can say this. When shit is out like that, it's something underneath that, and it wasn't destined to last like that. And Neo seemed to me to be old petty ass nigga, like, type shit, you know. Sir, just say you like what you like and like move the fuck around. You out here acting like a whole fucking female doing weird shit with the postings and shit, right? When they first got together, he was just acting real fucking weird, but fuck him. Anyway, I can't stand his ass. Anyway, I can't even tell you the name of a fucking Neo song. What that nigga made, a song where he was in it throwing a hat or something, wasn't he? I don't know. I don't know nothing about him. He just looked weird to me. I don't know. He looked like he a uncle that you need to keep your kids away from. That's the look that he give me. That's the vibe that he give me. I'm not putting nothing on nobody. I'm just saying that's the look that he give me when I see his face. Dudes like that got a face like that, and I just can't, yeah, I don't know. I just don't like it. So, you know, I felt some type of way about Crystal, and then I had to stop and realize, you know, these niggas be out here lying and wilding the fuck out, and they really don't be telling bitches that they got a woman at home. But here's where I fought women. You hoes a research, a whole fucking op. You find out everything you can about her, her motherfucking kids, her mama, her daddy, her neighbors, the motherfucker she worked with, the niggas she used to fuck, the niggas she dreamed of fucking. You do all that goddamn research, right? But you ain't picked up the motherfucking phone to fucking do research on the nigga that you parading all over the fucking Instagram and the Facebook and shit. Right? Why are you doing that? Because I'm sure if she had done a little bit of research, she would have come to know who Moneta was. But I feel like she already knew. And so, yeah. You is... yeah, the WB frog. I give you that. I give you that. She said Neo looked easy to draw or something. Can't put my finger on it. Oh, my God. But, yeah, I can't... I don't like Neo. I'm sorry. I never did. Never. From the moment I saw his ass, what the fuck wrong with this nigga? Who the fuck he is, right? because I felt like, you know, he thought he was going to be Michael Jackson off the wall or something. Boy, go sit your weird looking ass down. Ain't nobody thinking you cute out here. Ain't nobody throwing no panties on the stage for your fucking weird looking ass. No. Mm-mm. I'm sorry. During that versus, Frankie Beverly got more panties on the fucking stage than you ever could. And any weird ass bitch that's throwing her drawers on the stage for Neo, bitch. No. Mm-mm. And I don't know. I just don't like him. He just look like the type of dude that'll lie to a bitch and be telling her everything gonna be golden and then go stunt on the red carpet with a whole other bitch. Like, nigga. And they'd be telling you, but just hold me down at home, baby. Hold me down at home. Yeah, I'm gonna hold you down, all right? In some fucking water. Sure am. I'm gonna hold you down. The fuck? Till you stop fucking breathing. Put something in your food and knock your ass out while you in the tub. Mm-hmm. And just hold your ass underwater. Be like, damn, he slid under that, down into the tub and drowned. Oh, Lord, officer. Do y'all need a statement from me? Oh, you don't? Okay, well, thank you. Y'all have a good night. Well, ma'am, do you want to leave while we clean up? No, I'll just take the body. I got it. I'll clean it up. This is my house. I don't need y'all all up and through this motherfucker. Have a good night. Mm-hmm. And turn on the fucking Footloose song and start fucking wilding out. I don't like Neo. I'm sorry. I just don't. Right. Oh, no. I think he fell asleep. Right. He, you know, he took his medication and, you know, maybe the water was too warm and he just dozed off and then just slipped down in there and drowned. But the coroner will tell you what really happened, right? I ain't gonna have to hold him down hard, I promise you. You knock his ass out. Oh, Jesus. Anyway, y'all. So, yeah, I like that show. And so I was trying to tell y'all to salute y'all spirit and protect y'all peace. And I thought of Gaucher falling down them fucking stairs. I don't know where the fuck that thought came from, y'all. I really don't. But that fucking shit, like, it's a sound of, there's a sound that is made when that woman fall down them fucking stairs. Just go listen. It's episode 2. I'm telling you where it's at, y'all. I wish I had, screen recorded just that little bit so that I could play it for y'all, because I swear that is the funniest fucking shit. Yo, that shit is he fucking hilarious. And yeah, I'm sorry. It is what it is. That shit is funny. So if you haven't seen it, go fucking watch it. You know, support Black women, right? Support Black women. Let me see if I can get you a time stamp for the falling. Hold on. I hope it don't come through. Oh, it's quiet. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. Okay, it ain't happened yet. Hold on. I gotta get up to it. Hold on. I know when it happened. Oh, there you go. Okay, hold on. Hold on, y'all. Okay, so the timestamp for is episode 2. She starts walking at the 24-minute mark, y'all. When I tell y'all that fucking shit is he motherfucking hilarious. Let me see if I can, wait a minute, let me see. I can't believe I am sitting, y'all ain't shit. Cause y'all gonna sit right here like, well, let's see what she gonna do. Maybe she can make a way for us to see it. Oh my God. Okay, hold on, let me see. All right, I gotta be quiet cause I gotta let the microphone, I think it needs it to catch the sound. You don't need the fucking sound. You just got to see this lady fall down the stairs. Hold on, let me see. Like a bipolar ass mama or something. You don't need the fucking sound. Just fucking.
Okay, wait, hold on.
Okay. All right, so I just stopped it. Hold on. Now, I don't know. I don't think I need to do nothing to it. All right, hold on. I think it's trying to... Girl, I just need to make it so it can fuck a what's her name, okay? Like, I don't need all this extra shit. Hold on. All right, let me change the, damn. It's always trying to do something and fucking, 1080p. No, that's gonna take too long to fucking what's the name. Sorry, y'all. I had to fucking turn it down a little bit. I know, right? Sorry. Sorry. Okay, let me see. Now, I think I got it, y'all. We're going to see if I can upload this thing to the Yadig so I can play it for y'all. Now, remember, it ain't no goddamn sound, so don't get on my fucking nerves about it. Where the fuck is the thing at? Oh, there you go. All right, let's do it. All right, it's uploading. Ain't no damn sound. I just fucking said it. Ain't no damn sound. The fuck? That's our daughter going around asking her, what was that? And she just waved her off. Oh my God. Yo, that shit, I watched that fucking shit. I don't know how many fucking times, yo. I can't tell y'all how many times. The way that lady bounced down them fucking stairs, yo. Oh my God. The way she and it was the little music that they was playing and shit. And then she just fucking, she walking across and you could see her. And then the next oh my God. Yo, this is fucking stupid, right? She slid into a new step like nothing, yo. That fucking shit was hilarious. And I kept watching that fucking shit over and over and over again. I'm like, what the hell? I just told you wasn't a goddamn sound. She talking about the what's the name you dig is acting up. You so fucking silly. Ah, oh, Lord have mercy. So yeah. Now y'all see the shit that makes me fucking cackle. And I guess from laughing is the reason why my goddamn ass always falling down all the fucking time. And if you ask my husband, who by the way ain't been to nobody's fucking medical school, he gonna say it's because you always cleaning your fucking ears out all the goddamn time. You done thrown your fucking equilibrium off. Excuse me, sir. I wasn't puncturing my fucking eardrums, and I most assuredly wasn't fucking with the little hairs that help to balance us out that are inside our ears. Right, like, what the fuck? Girl, yes. Yes, I do. Yep, all in the video. Mm-hmm. But don't nobody get to see that shit but us. That's all. All right, y'all. So listen, I'm about to get the fuck out of here because, no God, it's about that time. And yeah, my food is smelling really good over there. And I'm about ready to dip it up out the pot. So I love y'all. Y'all have a great night again. Okay? Don't eat too much. And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all.